time has passed, that the intro music is gone, and we can introduce the show. This is wonderful. We're doing another one of these live hangouts, the Google hangouts, and we got all these wacky people here in this room today having a good time. Some people sharing their screen, others not. But our main guest of honor is Mr. John Henderson.
Hi, how you doing?
Hello, Mr. Anderson.
Yeah, nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
Yep. As our guest of honor, John Jones, is here. That's our main crew.
Howdy, howdy.
But we also got Brandon Bruce over here. We got some Jonathan Lambert over here in, what is that, Crying? No, UDK. He's over here in UDK, just rocking it. We got Lee over here. Who knows what he's in, and he's trying to figure it out.
Plants.
So, yeah, right on. John, would you like to give John a proper introduction? Since you have experience working with him, right?
Yes. Okay. So John Henderson is an officer in the local Austin IGDA, and he puts together kick-ass events for game developers in the area. And he's the Austin IGDA is one of the only IGDA chapters in the U.S. that's trying to be really fun, relevant, and useful. He's the mastermind and showrunner for the IGDA MicroTalks, which are usually 4 to 6 different 10-minute-long speeches from game developers on a single focus subject. And he's out at the Game Dev Beer Nights all the time. He's a fixture. He's a smart, funny motherfucker, and I've wanted him on here for a while. So welcome aboard, John.
Thanks so much, John.
Welcome, John.
Yeah, it's nice to be here.
We got all kinds of Johns.
Well, yeah, it's like toilets and guys who pick up hookers. Yes. There's always like 5 of us in, you know, grade school.
Well, my name technically means craving a toilet. And there's a JonesJohn.com, same spelling as mine, that sells portable camping toilets. Disposable.
Nice.
Yeah, because you don't want to keep them.
Don't tell me what to do.
Well, just to expand on what John said, like I've actually had a lot of success talking to just regular game developers of any stripe that, and because I know what you guys talk about, CrunchCast, it's right there in the title. The idea that game developers should be treated with respect as professionals, and that the craft that they're trying to play deserves at least some recognition. And we're not trying to save the world. We don't have the power to do that, but we do like Austin and the people that are here. We want you to feel appreciated, and people that decide they're coming here, we want them by any means possible to stay. And you know, like, we've certainly heard plenty about how so many different towns around the world losing opportunities for game developers, but you know, there are going to be ups and downs, and no one's immune from the boom and bust cycle. But you know, we like to think that we're giving game developers one more reason to stay in Austin. You know, certainly if they get out of work, they could, you know, depending on how experienced they are, they could just about go anywhere at all these days. But if they actually like living here, we'd rather they stay here.
Yeah, I mean, Austin's a fun place to live. It's hot as hell, but the cost of living is really cool. It's got a really neat culture. And there's, if you're someone that's starting a family or has a family, it's really easy to get a reasonable sized house close to the city. Or if you're younger and just off doing your own thing, if you're into nightlife or really anything in between, there's also a place for you there. It just sucks that the industry, or the Austin game industry, has been sort of a smoking crater for the last 4 years.
Well, I mean,
it is a fun place to be.
At least we're not Vancouver. No, those guys got it bad. I mean, or Boston.
Oh God, that! I'm curious to see how the 38 studios and Big Huge Games thing continues to develop. What was the name of that new studio that Epic started with the ex Big Huge Games guys?
Impossible Studios, and I have a connection to that because I'm actually friends with a guy named Ian Fraser, who was for all of 2 months the game director for what was then Big Huge Games, and was mostly designer for the game that they did ship. You know, 38 Studios' only major title before they got shut down. Finished box on the shelf. But if anyone was going to keep that team together, it was going to be Ian. So good, big ups to Ian and the former Epic Baltimore, now Impossible Games crew.
Yeah, I'm really glad that they opened up and were able to salvage some people from there. I'm curious to see what the startup situation up there is going to be. Because, I mean, it's really hard to kick people out of games, especially if they have no other relevant skills in life like me. But people, life always finds a way.
You always think about that. Like, what would I do? Sweep floors? Like, what would you really do? You could probably...
Wrestling. You'd do wrestling, wouldn't you?
Yeah. No, it's too old, too dangerous. No money. But, yeah. Anyway, sorry. Go ahead.
Well, there's some good things about Austin. I mean, what I like to say is that the pendulum keeps swinging. Between 2004 and 2006, there were things like, well, let's just review. EA shut down Origin. Acclaim went Chapter 7. You know, that's a bad kind of bankruptcy. That's like, this enterprise is no way of making money. We liquidate everything, and the landlord locks the doors so the people can't get in and get their stuff back. You remember that? That happened. That was bad. So, and then Microsoft shut down Digital Anvil, and at the tail end, Iron Storm shut down. So, there have been a few swings since then, but it's never been as bad as those 2 years. And the best part about it is, even with, you know, a few super huge studios that cut back occasionally and have attrition, at least we're way more diversified now than we were.
Do you have any concern about Austin's future in association with climate change? Have you heard anything about this?
Yeah.
I was a fan of the Year Zero album by Nine Inch Nails, and I played the alternate reality game quite a bit. And one of the websites that came out of that, I don't know if you're familiar with it at all, but it was the album by Nine Inch Nails that came out a few years ago. And there was this, the whole idea was that somehow scientists from 15 years from now sent back websites, or like mirrors of websites that you could look up now. And there was one called Viability Index. And it was all about how, you know, 15 years from now, everything Nebraska south to
there we go,
becomes completely uninhabitable. And then, like, Alaska becomes the new place to live that's hip and popular and actually temperate.
Yeah, I mean, there's actually a bunch of articles. You can just Google things like...
Wait, what the fuck did I come back in on? The audio's out for like 30 seconds since everything south of Nebraska is destroyed.
Yeah, that's what happened. It just turn on the news. Yeah. You know what? No one says that anymore. Remember we were joking earlier about things people don't say? Like me and John beforehand, we're talking about things like things people just don't say anymore. It's like, let's cut to the tapes. You know, like stuff like that. Because there's no tapes anymore. Yeah, I said, yeah.
Be so kind, rewind.
So he's like, yeah, cut on the news, God, man. Yeah. No, you just Google it now. It's like, get online, dude.
It's like the TV's all the way over there.
And I just faxed me in a memo.
No, it's a real thing. It could happen. But anyway, enough about climate change. No one wants to hear that.
Enough about climate change and archaic witticisms, yeah, and phrases.
Like, hey, do you know that everyone is going to die south of here, like, pretty soon, and you can, because it just happened. Yeah,
that kind of makes the awesome game industry not seem so shitty, huh? Yeah. Could be burning to death or freezing to death.
Hey, that was last year. Let's not go back there. Last year was the fall when everything was on fire. So
that was Colorado summer 2012. Everything was burning.
Oh yeah. God, that's right. I didn't even think you guys had enough air. Air oxygen up that high, yeah, right, to sustain a fire.
It was burning all of it up. We couldn't breathe.
Well, it was in the valley, right? The valley was burning.
It was mostly, I can't say exactly where all of them were. They were more in like Fort Collins and Colorado Springs.
NDA?
Area. I can't say because of my NDA.
Yeah, yeah, I always heard that anyone that moves to Colorado has to sign an NDA about adverse weather conditions.
Oh, it's never that bad.
Or Kids in Balloons. Everybody broke that one.
Yeah, look at all this snow.
It's snowy here.
Has anyone else seen John's video frozen? I hear him fine, but I don't see
him. Oh, goddamn it.
Oh, John's... Yeah, John's video is frozen.
All my shit hiccuped.
Well, it happens sometimes where it'll freeze and come back after a while.
Yeah.
But if you really want to, you could always just, like, leave and rejoin. Just because we're not full now.
Are we not?
Nah. Only 6 people here, folks.
What's the cap? Because someone said they couldn't get in.
Who? Really?
The cap is 10.
It's supposed to be 10. Yeah.
Yeah, it is 10 because I couldn't get in. That's the one I encountered.
No, weird.
We should make a lobby.
A lobby. A hangout for people trying to get into the hangout?
The door.
Crabs in a bucket.
No, that would be talking
about it there.
Oh, yes. God,
all right, I'm going to rejoin real quick.
Okay, cool. Hey, John, you got anything to fill in about, like, did you have anything more to, like, about Austin, or was it cut off? Like...
Oh, well, yeah, so what we're trying to do with the IGDA chapter, like I said, is just to give game developers something to make them feel like they're welcomed and provide information for as many outside the industry groups, such as government organizations and civic groups. And actually, just the other day, the story you may have heard about near the Texas A&M University in Bryan, College Station, a couple weeks ago, a guy went on a rampage and shot some people. Well, recently it was found that he was mentally ill, holed up in his house, and his family told his lawyer that he played video games a lot. Don't know what else he did in his house all day, but, well, our local Fox affiliate wanted to do a story about it and just pick two, you know, sources, one supposed behavior expert about, you know, the effect of video games and how it can make people violent or not really or something. And so they needed someone else to talk about it, so they asked Jennifer Bullard, who's our chapter chair, and she's saying, well, you know, I've played video games for all my life, and I've been working in games for 15 years and never tried to shoot anyone. So it's, what the nice thing about it is it's not even worth wringing your hands about. People don't really talk about it that much anymore, at least none of the people I encounter. Certainly people that have just experienced some traumatic event and are going through grief, like the families of the people who got shot, they may be looking for someone to blame, and you can't really blame them for that. But at the same time, well, they're broken people and they like to do lots of things, you know, in their brokenness. But does those things, you know, bear the blame? Like what the Alfred Hitchcock quote that I heard recently about how people who do violence may have drunk some milk right beforehand. So then do you blame the milk? But
it does somebody good.
But the good news is that she was available to take the phone call. As I understand, she did it in her car on the way home, or maybe just in the parking lot. So that's what we think that IGDA should be about, and we're just the Austin chapter, like we said. And we've had, I mean, having actual game developers, professionals show up to our events, that's our validation. Because honestly, we're never going to run out of people fascinated by video games and the idea that, oh, you make them for a living. Well, I would really like to do that. How do you do that? And they'll get right up in your face, kind of like this. It's like, you're in the game industry? You can get me a job. Please give me a job.
Everybody loves those guys.
You should come to Game Dev Beer Night and say that.
Yes.
That's what I was going to go right into is, hey, aren't you guys doing those beer nights and stuff?
I think that's...
Kills you.
Fortunately, I've never had to bounce anybody for doing that, but it's on the table.
All right, nobody heard any of that because both Johns spoke at the same time.
Still not seeing any video from you.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure that out. I think my poor little USB or a powered USB hub is overwhelmed by something. Not even my laptop built-in webcam is working.
But yeah, that's one thing about the IGDA is that there are chapters all over the place, and there are some that you know, there are oftentimes just a bunch of students that go to meetings and talk about how much they would like to have local game studios to employ them.
Whoa.
They make that sound.
John Jones just exploded, everyone.
Sorry.
Climate change has affected John Jones.
I saw TCP/IP settings. My God.
Make sure you have enough TV.
Yeah. IP and deadly bees.
Did you unplug it and plug it back in? Is it turned
yeah.
on?
And then,
have you made sure it's on or off again?
blow on it. Just give it a little tap. Just a little tap.
Chris, I'm not falling for that again.
Just do it slowly. Slowly.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
Just blow on it like an
I heard that question.
Yeah. Cool. So while John's having technical difficulties, here's something that's been bugging everybody in the last few days thanks to recent game releases. People not getting credited.
Oh, God.
What's up with that?
I think that sucks.
I think it's pathetic there are no actual standards for that. Although, John, maybe you'll speak to this. I know the IGDA put together a list of crediting standards. It's been developed over the years. It's actually incredibly, incredibly well thought out.
That's right. And that part is actually done by IGDA Central. The standards do exist. What I'm sure a lot of professionals would like is for the IGDA as a whole to have enough credit to actually enforce such things. I mean, credit is one of those many things that industry professionals and, in fact, many studios would like there to be a body that more or less enforces those standards. And, or otherwise that the competition themselves wouldn't get it done.
Now, what is it in Hollywood exactly? The Writers Guild, isn't that like... Isn't that what they have up there? Which is pretty much like that. They make sure that credits they have to be very accurate.
Right. And there's a Reddit Writers Guild, and there's also the Screen Actors Guild. And there's actually a number of different unions. And that's one thing that a lot of people will say they would wish IGDA, if you know, they don't use the term, they would like it to be a union. And there's some debate about that. But then again, how many people here are or have ever been paid IGDA members?
I have been.
I've been through a company.
Right, and a lot of people have. That's been the thing. I was talking to some friends just recently who was talking about how they members only because their company paid for it. And in that sense... there's a real chance for the individual developers to get a real disconnect about, you know, what is this for? This funny card? You know, I could go to this website and, well, that kind of sounds interesting, but I'm really busy and we got a game to ship, so how does this really affect me? That's been an ongoing thing, and it's one of the many things that IGDA is realizing is not a one-and-done proposition. You really have to make the value proposition about why... you invest any time or even brain power to this other thing other than your career. You're a game developer. You're what? You're interested in my project, my career, sleep, maybe.
Well, sleep is for the weak.
Coffee. Now, the best I can say about it is we are absolutely in the distraction business. We think that game developers ought to be presented with something worthy of their distraction.
I like that.
I think going back to just talking about the credits, I believe like if anything you've done is in the game and you can actually physically play and see something that you've done or heard what you've done in the game and it's being used and put on the shelves or downloaded, you should be in the credits.
Right. One of the things, I think the big thing that a lot of people are barking about right now is say if you're at a company and you worked on the game and you were there in development, but you weren't there for the game's actual ship, then they take you off the credits. And that's happened at plenty of studios before. Obviously, the main gripe that's happening right now is with Darksiders 2. But it happened at Warhammer. People were told if they left, then they wouldn't be credited on Warhammer Online. Which is ridiculous. Like, major players, like, leads. There's a major lead left. It's like, what?
At least they know, but still, fuck them up and down.
Yeah, and it was...
I have, for those of you who have been in projects like this, have you ever asked why you're working on a game, whose job is it to keep the credits?
It's the marketing people.
Either marketing people or an associate producer, nothing else to do.
Yeah, but do you know who it is while you're working on it? Do you know whose job it is to keep track of getting credit?
I don't think I ever knew that. I did have one client, though, where the studio director was the one doing it. Even went down to the point of finding out the names of the individual contractors of the outsourcing studios we were using and then getting them in the credits and making sure they had all their proper titles. And it started from the studio director on down. I've never seen it done like that anywhere else. I thought that was actually pretty rad.
Actually, one of the designers I used to work with actually went ahead and submitted to like Moby Games because the game that he was on never even went online.
You have to prove a lot of shit to be able to get on there, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would just want to add two things really quick. Ilphonic, I think they did a really good job with their credits. Our credits list has like a few hundred people listed, even good though God. We're a small studio and we really only 10 people made the game. We were just very specific to make sure every name that we could that's supposed to be there is in there. Like if it's, you know, if they did anything at all, and we had a, you know, we wanted to make we originally had this idea of individual game assets being shown with credits next to them. Wow. But that just ended up being like the UI was such a nightmare that it was just something that just didn't happen. But it was a cool idea. It was just that's how we looked at it, is we wanted to make sure everybody really got put in the spotlight. It wasn't just the game. It was making sure everybody got credited well. And we had guys that were, you know, released on not so great of terms that they even have the full credits page, which has like their picture and bio and everything.
Well,
and we didn't get rid of it, but at the same time, I've been at a company where I was on a project for the pre-production and basically set up how everything worked, the whole environment pipeline for this tool with another tech artist, and was on the project for like the first half of it, but then shipped it over to another team. And I still had to fight to get on the credits, even though I didn't even leave the company. I was still there, and they didn't want to put me on the credits. But then I got listed as additional artist.
Yeah. So that's
was
absurd.
Like, it was ridiculous. It was ridiculous.
I was wondering what. There's obviously a disconnect between some people who prepare the credits and the employees who read them, and there's probably even a greater disconnect between the people who play the games and might occasionally read Moby Games to see who worked on what. You know, titles are next to meaningless. What you were talking about, Chris, earlier about associating individual names with individual assets, that's probably the level of detail that would be necessary to convey that information as accurately as possible, but that's not going to be feasible for most projects.
Oh, right, exactly, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was a hope, you know? Like you know when you want that sweet gameplay feature that's just, maybe in the sequel if we can get there. That kind of shit.
Oh, yeah, totally.
But,
in my mind, yeah, nothing to say against professionals that, you know, want credits, rightfully so, but one of my maxims, and I know John and Brandon have heard me gripe about it quite a bit, is how much does the consuming public know about, really know even the basics about what goes into a game and what, you know, talents and what effort goes into it, not just the hours spent and the number of people, you know, working on it, but what is it that they actually do?
That's true.
Yeah, it's just one of the bigger things you run into.
How are they going to appreciate any level of credits?
What is a key grip anyway? What is a best boy?
What's a gaffer?
Yeah. What's this fluff for everybody keeps talking about? We were literally thinking the same thing.
Back in 2002, never mind.
The one thing that I'd say, okay, about this whole credits thing.
Never talk about how we met.
It seems like we all kind of agree that anybody that worked on it should probably get their credit regardless. And even Hollywood has all these standards in place just to make sure that what causes someone to say, I'm not putting that guy in. And here's the, it's kind of a dual way. I think it's their ego or whatever you call it, their whole personality, the way they feel, their opinion. You're putting their opinion above reality, so it's a form of disbelief. It's a form of say, oh yeah, you didn't even work on this game because you fucking fuck you for whatever reason. That's literally what it is. It's the creation of disbelief. It's coming from someone's brain, or I'll give this. It could be ignorance, and by ignorance I mean just not knowing, like, whoever put together the list, because that was something that came up quite a bit a little while back. There is who's putting together that list. Right. It could be somebody that they're honestly just ignorant to who was there the whole time. They're just like, who works here, and just like look up some list of people and then they just grab it from a spreadsheet or something.
In my database. Mind, it would have to be someone with producer level clout who would have at least some inkling, or it should have been their job to understand who these people are and what their contributions should have been to compile the list. And honestly, how many producers have you met that are, not only that motivated, but make it clear from the get-go for everyone? And that's why I asked you, did you know whose job this was? Well, it should have been someone at that level, and they should have told you early.
They should have started compiling that from day one.
Sure. And should have made it clear to everyone. In my mind, if I was working on a project like that, that would be reason for me to stay.
That would be
in advance. Someone is telling me I'm appreciated. I'm going to get in the credits.
They're giving enough shit about you and your contribution to the game instead of, okay, here is a slot. This is the slot that is filled. This is the person and the name that fills it. That's not important.
There's a game that comes out next year that I probably will not be in the credits, even though I worked on it a long time ago.
That's a shame.
But I would be surprised. I'll still buy it. I'll see if I'm in the credits.
That's always fun when you finally see your name in the credits. Like, yeah, I got in there. It's funny. Why am I in the credits for this game? I did jack.
It's even better when you go to GameStop and you buy your game, and then the GameStop clerk says, oh, this game sucks. And you're like, yeah, I worked on that.
I'm actually on the screen right now. You guys can't see it. I'll show it to you. I'll link it to you. But I was putting up my credit screen for Nexus, which is literally like a whole blurb. I got to write whatever I wanted on there for the most part.
I did notice in the Nexus editor, you guys have your faces in the levels.
Yes.
As little icons. I thought that was very cool. Very, very little Easter egg there. I thought it was pretty good to see who worked on what level, I guess.
What they are, well, it's not an Easter egg or anything like that. It's a mutator called Ilphonic. And...
Oh, cool.
There's actually a whole section of the wiki on it, how to add, because you have to add it to your map if you want to get your map official.
Okay.
I guess. Like, to support all the dynamic mutators. And there's a few you have to set up, and one of those is Kilphonic, which is you basically just drop in these heads, which is an entity, and then you have to assign the materials, because it's the same mesh for every face. But there's like 10 or different whatever. I forget how many different ones there are. Point is, you can just set up your own face. You can take your own picture and make a custom map.
It's pretty badass.
With just your face. Awesome. Yeah. When they call the Ilphonic mutator, it'll be your face shooting laser beam eyes at the players trying to kill them. And you have to shoot them.
Nice.
So you can do that yourself if you want. You can have the Lee Amarakoon mod for Nexus.
Now you really cool. can be in the game.
Man.
Yeah. But yeah, the one
now
point
you're
is,
playing with power.
Yeah. You know that whole idea, like where he said,
now you can shoot your friends' big fat faces.
So yeah, I mean, you'll get that whole issue, that whole topic of ignorance, who's not really taking care of the list. But I have known situations, like I said, I've been at companies where they left people out, and I knew the exact individual who made the decision. And for me, that was like, that's just horrible. That's pathetic. Like like I said earlier, you're saying, hey, fuck you for whatever reason I'm choosing to say fuck you. You didn't make this game, even though you did, and it's in your resume and everybody knows. There's your work right there.
That's the other thing I always wonder about whenever I hear, game developers talking about credit, is that obviously you're going to feel a certain way if you get left out, and that's normal, and I totally respect that. But professionally, how does it affect you? Because, like you said, other people that you work with...
Right. It doesn't really hurt you, but...
I've only ever heard of a handful of situations, like maybe one or two, where that's ever actually mattered. Someone, just like a dickish potential employer saying, well, I didn't see your name in the credits. I didn't prove you worked on it. Outside of that, I don't think, and those are extreme edge cases, I really don't think it actually matters other than showing respect for the people that poured their sweat, blood, and tears into doing it. Granted, they paid you for that, but still, it's such a basic show of respect. I don't see why you wouldn't.
Right. It's the idea is that it doesn't really matter. So the point that the person is doing this to someone, if they're the one, if in fact it is the case where there is someone that chooses who's on the list, even though they know people work there.
Right.
If it's that case versus a case of simple ignorance, then what's the fucking point? Just so you can fucking jack off later and think about the fact that, yeah. Yeah, fucking. I got power. I got swag. I got swing at this company. I said you didn't do it. Yeah. And then they just shoot. They just blow their load all over themselves. Well, that's exactly what's going on.
Maybe it depends on your contribution.
Maybe it depends.
Yeah, okay. Okay, some guy comes in and fucking is terrible and smashes up some computers. Fuck that guy.
Don't smash. No, but like, what if you're working an asset that's worked on by multiple people? Sometimes you don't have anything to show that you can actually say that you did by yourself specifically. But
you ever watch a TV show and you see that it's written by someone? Well, many shows don't have individual people. Most TV shows have writing teams. And if you actually talk to any of them, well, they kind of have some weird voodoo that makes it where they have to just credit one or two people. They can't credit the whole team, even though pretty much every episode is written by the team. So this is not unique to the game industry, and I'll give you an even bigger, history lesson. Who created Batman? Well, it will be...
Don Knotts.
Tim Effin Burton.
I still say the mugger that killed his parents.
Right.
But please, go on.
Good answer.
Generally... Every time a TV show or a movie says Batman created by Bob Kane, well, who was Bob Kane? He was the artist. Anyone knows anything about comic books is that usually it's a creative team of a writer and the artist. So who wrote Batman? Well, as it turns out, it was a guy named Bill Finger who never signed his work and was never credited by his own choice, which is weird, but that's what he wanted. Now, people like Bill Finger's estate is actually recently trying to get some royalties from the Christopher Nolan Batman series. Why? Because he created the Joker.
Oh, God.
And no one knows his name. There's a whole book recently that came out called Bill the Boy Wonder that's all about this. So,
God, that's...
Mind is blown.
Not getting credit for Batman... That's like worse than being crucified.
But that's the way it is. I mean, at least, everyone heard about the Superman saga recently, but that was Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster. I can't remember which one was the writer and which one was the artist, but it was one and two. But at least they got, people know their names. Who knows Bill Finger?
That's an excellent
point. I don't
know,
but his name's kind of funny.
Hold my finger, or what?
Bill got fingered.
Yeah.
Willy finger.
Oh, you mean in a police lineup?
He got fingered. Yeah, nice. Oh, you and your encyclopedic knowledge of cop show jargon.
Yeah, it's...
Hey, let me throw in some terms from the past, you guys.
Gee willikers shucks.
He's doomed to be a Tom Green joke.
Yeah. It's a good reference. It's a good reference, by the way.
Holy good reference.
Love that movie. Love that movie. It's so funny.
Nice. Like
some sausage. Yeah, this whole thing.
I'll be back in one quick second.
Right on.
I can't see you, so that's okay.
So, I mean, it's always weird credits, and it's unfortunate because I know that it's a kind of a blow to people, but yeah, I feel like, yeah, we are kind of like, whatever, because it doesn't really matter, but at the same time,
yeah, it does.
It's still kind of a dick move.
It's a quality of life issue. It is one of those issues that comes into question every time anyone shows any doubt about whether game developers should be shown any kind of respect. And respect is one of those things. Well, you can't buy it, you can't sell it, you can't eat it, doesn't pay your rent, but you want it. And I think you deserve it. But by what measure and who, again, it's ultimately going to come down to who's tasked with doing it, because you know, you all have professional standards. Someone's judging your work, so who is watching that watcher? The best studios, I would argue, don't have this problem because they have the standard from the get-go, and everyone knows it, and everyone knows exactly what he and she are supposed to do, and that they'll get credit for it. It's just not an issue, but
right,
everyone
right.
else just doesn't know.
Yeah, it shouldn't be an issue, and in the respect is it's a good way of looking at it. It's one that can be quickly overlooked.
There's a term called hygiene issue. Which is to say that, you know...
Yeah, I knew guys that needed to take showers a lot, they didn't.
But you don't need more hygiene, you just need enough to the point where it ceases to be an issue. They cease to stink, but they don't smell a different way.
Hey, my armpits stink, I better scrub a little more.
Yeah.
Maybe I should trim these grizzly hairs.
What the hell did I come back to?
We totally switched the program to talking about... cosmetology.
The cosmetologic cast.
So, how's your hair doing, John? I know we can't see it, but...
Yeah. You are not the first game developer I've heard with that reaction to the term hygiene issue, Chris.
Game developers are disgusting. That, I think.
Some of the most... so much sense.
I mean, I've been in enough jobs and I've met enough crazy people that I know that there's... All walks of life have people that are just disgusting. But in the game industry, you're basically got a bunch of guys. You're like, I mean, they're like right out of school, or some guy just sits from the computer all day, just dicking around. Oh, I'm gonna just jack off and then fucking do some art and not even get up and wash my hands. You know, like wrappers, Burger King bags everywhere. You know, stuff like that. Oh, I'm
like
done.
Egg McMuffins.
I'm done eating this. I'm gonna set it on the floor and never pick it up. Or I've got to go to the bathroom.
Dude.
I'm not going to aim at the toilet. I'm just going to bend over in front of it and spray the wall.
Spray and pray.
And that was a problem we had at a company I worked at.
Spray? Did you say spray cray? What?
No, spray and pray.
Spray and pray, yeah. Oh, okay. But no, that's just the reality is I've known a lot of crazy, just unhygienic developers. It's just ridiculous people.
Well, in a way, it kind of fits because, you know, people that gravitate towards the game industry oftentimes are the people who like escapism. Certainly the people that play games are like that, but it's not outside the realm of possibility. But this is why it's a good idea. This is why I come back to gender politics. If you had a woman in the house, that shit wouldn't happen. You need a den mother to come over and just be like, pick that shit up.
Exactly.
Well, actually, there's an amusing related anecdote. One of my clients right now is in a building with a couple other developers, and we're directly across from their QA department. And on the first floor, it's just all their QA and then our small studio in the men's restroom, the women's restroom. And on the second floor, it's all just basic office job type companies, and for whatever reason they're mostly staffed by women. Well, most of the people in my studio have gradually found that going to the men's restroom downstairs, it's like a fucking war zone. It's the most horrible, disgusting place on earth, because it's just all dudes, this massive number of dudes. They're destroying the bathroom faster than anybody else can clean it. And everybody goes to the bathroom upstairs just because nobody ever uses that. And I really do think it comes down to like certain personality types, certain careers. Man, that made it sound like I was dissing really hard on QA hygiene. But no, it's just like that many like game developer type people in one place at one time crunching their asses off. Just considerations like, have I showered this month? Just sort of slip from your mind.
Oh, exactly. And, you know, the one thing I want to make, I didn't make as clear as it should be made. Most people I've worked with are fine. Like, they're not that bad. But there's always the standouts.
Yeah.
Like, and when it's a standout that affects something that you see
or smell.
Smell burns into your memory.
Yep.
And yeah, so there's the standouts, if you will. But and to go
like that guy got laid off. Who wants his chair? No one.
Yeah. Let's take it out back and burn it.
Yeah, I know one of those cases. But not just to play off what you were saying there, John, I worked at a company and it was like a big building, real big building, and it had a bunch of different companies in it on different floors. But the company had other, they have multiple floors they owned as well. So they're kind of like some floors were like half a bunch of old guys in suits. I don't know what they even did. Place looked nice. And the other half was like, you know, QA or like a whole big art department or something, whatever. And yeah, every floor had those toilets that were open to everybody. And you would find, if you've got the option, folks, try to find those toilets. The special ones that no one uses. And here's a tip.
Well, if there's a dress code, sometimes it can be better.
Yeah. Well, here's my big game development tip. If your company you're working at has a bathroom in a gym. They have a gym in your building. They have a gym, like, you know, working out, like fucking treadmills and fucking weights and stuff. If they have a bathroom, use that because no one is ever using the gym at your game dev studio. It's the cleanest bathroom in the whole place, man. I've had that happen. That's spectacular. I've worked at plenty of companies that had little gyms, and the gym was always fine, but bathrooms desolate. You would see a tumbleweed go through there. It's just like that. You hear that, and there's a crickets chirping and shit, and there's vultures like circling.
It's like on the treadmills, like, you know, the thin plastic sheeting to cover up like an LCD screen. They're all still on.
Oh yeah, the treadmills, dust. Like, yeah, this is my tip to you up and coming gangsters trying to get in the game industry.
Just find the best restroom possible. Yeah, the gym. That's really good. I'll remember that.
Yeah. Well, you know the studio we're in now, right, John? You've been there, so you know. Yeah. You've seen it. Just to give a quick synopsis to everybody, it's kind of a downtown old school building. From back in the days when there was an old fur company there, so it's kind of like an antique building, so they maintain it historically.
Was it like the Jonas Brothers Furrier?
Yes, Jonas Brothers Furrier, this big neon sign on top of it. If you go through Denver, if you went down Broadway, you know you've seen this building. It's right fucking there. And it used to be an old furs, like from an old fur trapper back in old school Colorado. But point is, now it's like downstairs is this one club, and there's like all these clubs, and there's like a pawn shop, and... And upstairs it's been all these different things, but right now, on the second floor is us, and above us is basically nothing. They'll have a show up there, like sometimes, like a month back or something, they had a fashion show up there. But usually it's just desolate. So we could just go up there into this like fully, you know, it's like going into a club that is empty, but clean. And there's men's and women's restrooms, so if you really want the privacy... You can just go upstairs to this bathroom no one has ever used. It's the best.
That would be right.
Fantastic.
I hate it when somebody doesn't flush and you go use the bathroom and there's like a nice brown water that's left over for you to visit.
Horrible.
Dude, in the like the horrible toilets that I was telling you about before at my place now, It takes like four flushes just to get rid of pee.
How come there's always this point in the show where we break down and start talking about poop and stuff?
I don't know. I don't know. One thing I did want to say on the subject of credit, not credit for poo. One thing it just popped in my head a moment ago about what Mr. Henderson was saying. Finding out who handles credits at your studio, like when you start a new job or even the job where you're working now, find out who. Just make a point and find out who that is. Kind of, you know, get a sense of, you know, who owns it, and then try and keep in touch like with that person as the project gets closer to wrapping. And if you can, this is probably excessively anal, try and document what you do and what you contributed to. It's almost a needless paper trail, but I mean, it really can't hurt. But find out who that is, and then as the game gets closer to shipping, just figure out what the lay of the land there is.
Especially at a larger company, too. If you're at a small company like where we're at now, obviously they know what you did because there it is, and you're the only person that fucking did that thing.
Right.
But if you're at a large company, then they don't know.
Well, you guys did forget to credit Ryan McConnell, which I thought was kind of surprising.
But you know, real quick, I just want to say how just to add one more just nice how good our bathrooms are. We have those urinals that flush automatically. You don't touch them, so the bathroom stays so clean. Like you know how much dirtiness is accumulated just from people grabbing that handle and flushing it. Anyway.
Absolutely.
I wanted to throw out a quick anecdote based on what you just said there. I knew a guy at a company I worked with, and he was being kind of put on that chopping block review situation because somebody gave him a bad review. Because the guy was just an asshole. It's an asshole. There's nothing more.
The reviewer or reviewee?
The guy that was reviewing him.
Okay.
The guy that was in charge was literally, for no other reason than just an asshole, because what he did was, these things on files, when you save them, they're called timestamps.
Yeah.
And those don't lie.
They don't?
Timestamps don't lie. So all he did is he...
Just like big butts.
He just went into, whatever you got, you got Visual Source Save, you got Perforce, whatever you got on your studio, you just grabbed a list of his files and grabbed timestamps. And compared them with over the time that he was on this project, and just printed up this giant. It was like 50 pages, a big stack of paper, and just threw it on their desk and said, "There, proof that that motherfucker is lying."
That's awesome.
And he still got fucked because of politics.
Oh man!
There's one company I worked with at one point where the high ranking technical art guy just had it out for somebody else, and whenever there'd be a review for that guy's work, he would go into Perforce and then uncheck certain files and certain things in a way he knew how it would work to break that guy's stuff before everything he did, and end up getting him fired over that after doing that for a while, and he found a way to cover his tracks, which is just tremendously evil.
How'd you find out about it?
A guy that I think was in the middle of it and saw it as it was happening, and it actually verified the guy's work that was getting screwed over, verified that it worked, and then figured out more or less how it was getting broken. But it was too late to do anything.
Yeah. So they did fire the guy that was actually screwing the other guy.
No, they fired the guy that the guy destroyed.
Oh.
Yeah, the guy that screwed over the other guy is still there.
That asshole.
Yep. It's just amazing the lengths of evil some people will go through. But I love what Chris said about using Perforce check-ins as proof. That's pretty badass.
But like I think we can all agree, we can have standards and we can have people watching out for each other, but there is no substitute for people just being genuine and professional with each other throughout the life of the project.
Yes.
True.
And there's no guarantee of that, is there?
No. It's sad. I mean, this industry employs so many children and people that just don't know how to be. Like, I've had my own growing pains with that because I've done this since I was 16 and I didn't know shit about shit, just learning how to coexist with other people and I mean, at least I always tried, but sometimes just social graces and whatnot don't come naturally to people.
Right, but I will digress again and suggest that distraction, that's one of the things that we, at least in the back of our mind, I'm giving people an opportunity to talk to one another. It's really, I know you have in the same mind, John, when you think about beer night, you're giving people practice talking to each other as people and sharing each other's company for, you know, however long it takes you to drink several beers. With no expectation of games other than social contact. And what I like to say a lot of the time is you never get good at anything unless you practice.
Exactly.
You don't practice unless you have the opportunity.
Exactly. And I'm having been socially awkward for a great deal of my life. I can smell my own. So whenever I see somebody that I can tell kind of has a hard time socially, or if they're sort of like hanging out the edge of a circle or don't know how to join a conversation, I try to go out of my way to, well, first off, remember their name or learn it really quickly. Just wave them over into the circle and then just kind of interrupt the conversation and introduce them around. If I know something about them, like, this is Chris. He works over at Edge of Reality. He's a programmer. And he's a really cool dude. And here's John, here's Paul, just sort of introduce them around and sort of try and guide them into a conversation a little bit. And I've seen a lot of people, I just realized that could, that example, shit, that may, that could sound like it applied to someone, but it totally didn't. No, I just realized, oh God, there's a big enough studio that could actually apply to somebody somewhere. That was not an actual example. Fuck, I feel bad. But I've actually seen a lot of people kind of improve and learn and even get jobs or contracts out of them going out there learning how to be. I'm not trying to toot my own horn here or anything, but it's interesting seeing where game developers can start out, but most importantly, just through practice, seeing where they can end up. And I think that's a few levels beyond hygiene.
Oh, yeah. No, I've actually seen those situations where there's been guys on interviews and kind of afterwards people are like, that's not a guy I really want to hang out with.
Which is unfair. And,
but well, it's the whole point of interviews is the personality process, too. You have to make sure you fit with the company culture. If you're, if you're coming into some place with some completely different views as everyone else, there's going to be issues in development, so...
But, yeah.
Obviously, we should all be open-minded and stuff like that. But I'm just talking about, you know when it happens.
Yep.
Like, if somebody says a certain thing, and there's a certain way you do things at your studio, then you might be like, this is going to be trouble.
Try not to talk about My Little Pony during the interview.
Fuck you!
I don't know, man. I think nowadays, that might be the hot shit. You bring that up, and you roll in there if you're fucking... Friendship is Magic gear on. You might, people might be up on that because the internet. It's like cats, man. Rock a fucking kitten shirt.
I actually know a story of a guy that cosplayed his way into submitting a resume to Epic and ended up getting a job.
Was that the dude that just rolled up Stormtrooper style?
Stormtrooper style. Yep.
Yeah, that guy. That's like a classic story. That dude that just rolled in there for the Stormtrooper outfit or whatever.
And he was in character. Completely in character the whole time. He ended up inadvertently drawing a crowd, handed off his resume, and then just goose-stepped his way right out. And everybody was super impressed. They saw his work, and he was basically insta-hired. He's still there. I think he might be a lead now, but he's like a super, super important fucking dude at the company. And he was,
'cause it's a long time ago when he was originally hired. Several
years. Is he like an artist or something like that, or what did he do?
Yep, artist, if I remember correctly. Yeah, it was pretty badass. That being said, I wouldn't suggest if you're a furry, I wouldn't suggest.
Well, there's a line. There's a line between something being ridiculous and radical, versus something being that's crazy and acceptable. Obviously, if anybody rolled up to me in a Stormtrooper outfit, I would not be worried. I'd just be like, "Hey, what's going on, Stormtrooper dude?"
Let's be honest, though. How hard is it to be in character when you're a Stormtrooper? It's in like...
So, I heard these aren't the droids you're looking for.
Yeah.
This is the resume you're looking for. I was just thinking of applying to Rovio, the Angry Birds guys. just dress up as an angry bird and just fucking throw your resume in there in a big wadded up ball of paper, trying to knock over as much as you can.
Someone like set up a huge fuck off slingshot right outside the office, paint your face red, and fling yourself at the door.
if you want to be
in the Rovio office and saying, "Yeah, we've seen people try that before. Don't."
Hey, if you want to be subtle, you can just throw up the birds.
Throw birds at windows. But it'd be funny if they're used enough to that they had the receptionist have a big pig costume ready to just get into and walk out and just be like, "Fuck you, I've seen this 100 times. Then kick him over and laugh.
So here's something that's really, really big and everybody's probably talked about a lot and they might even be sick of, but what do you guys think of Mars? So we got Curiosity just landed. How cool is that? Was that? Did anybody watch that live stream?
You know what? Yeah. I didn't watch it, but I read a lot about it on Facebook.
Same.
I heard we landed on some planet.
It was ridiculous that they were like, okay, we're there, we're fucking landing, and then I'm watching it on the live stream. It was like a Monday night. So it was really late. And they're like, okay, here's fucking images from Mars, like, within a few minutes. Like, holy shit.
It was great. It was like going back on the internet to 1995. They're all getting interested in a 64x64 image of a wheel.
Yeah, it was a sweet, you know, yeah. Look at these thumbnails. And it was interesting, like, no understanding what they're talking about in that aspect of it. That's what I immediately went to. It's like, oh, yeah, I understand. They got, like, you know, high-res images, and they're coming down, but they got the thumbnails now, and they're just waiting for it to load. So I was feeling them, bro.
He actually had to swap out the entire operating system of the Curiosity unit. Apparently it doesn't have enough memory to load the landing program and the roving program.
It's pretty crazy. I follow it on Twitter. You can follow it. It's like Curiosity or whatever.
Yeah.
I'll find it. But it's interesting to read its stupid tweets.
Wait, it's tweeting as it rolls. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, at Mars Curiosity. It's the Curiosity rover. It has tweets like, "Incoming, watch my heat shield hitting the ground on Mars and raising a cloud of dust." Video. And it's like, there's a video, there's a link, and it's like, hashtag MSL. And that's what. And when I'm reading these, I'm imagining that it's this fucking robot actually writing these tweets. And that's the way I think about it. And it makes it more interesting that way.
Dude, so totally.
I'm like, this robot is such a prick. He's always fucking retweeting shit over and over.
And then before you know it, you know, Curiosity's going to start tweeting food pics. Hey, today I had eggs.
Yeah.
Eggs with Instagram.
Sitting on the toilet. Please retweet.
How can you tell?
It's like an off-color picture of a rock.
All of Mars looks like an Instagram. Have you seen what color it is?
Exactly. I just had the idea. Like, you guys know how there's like not Steve Jobs or fake Steve Jobs, or like, you know, they pretend to be a celebrity but they're not. Well, if there's evil Curiosity rover or just angry Curiosity rover, everything's just bitching. It's like, it sent me to fucking Mars. Oh, look, another goddamn rock. Just like this really bitchy or passive aggressive shit. I would also follow that.
Cold.
Do what?
The air stinks really bad here. It's
cold. Everything hurts all the time. What? Why did they give me the capacity to feel pain?
Just think of it like Rosie the Robot from the Jetsons.
Actually, I read a couple cool things about the Curiosity rover. On Reddit, they did an AMA, which means Ask Me Anything. And by the way, John, click on the chat tab in the upper left.
Here's the joke I saw on Reddit about that AMA, where it cuts to that Good Burger kid, and he's reading something. He's like, oh, yeah, yeah, I know some of these words.
Welcome to Good Burger. Can I take your order?
God.
I know.
Fuck. But in that big questionnaire thing, two of the things that they talked about that I thought were kind of neat were, they asked, what is, hey, Jesse Sosa, what's up, dude?
What?
Jesse. We're gonna have two people with a black background. Oh, what? I got heads.
Oh, my phone.
Hey, look, there's Jesse's forehead. Remember that joke we made earlier? Yes. Everybody? Look, there's Jesse's forehead.
I just got out of the shower.
MySpace shot. Dude, no. Bad Jesse.
Where is the fluffer when you need one?
No fluffer on Earth could fix that.
Right. Well, yours doesn't involve Mars either, I don't think.
No, just Uranus. Sorry. And there went Jonathan.
So yeah, I'm back now. And
WBLOL.
I've never had it freak out that bad before.
Hey, yo.
But luckily, thanks to the powers of editing, I'll just be able to cut all that out, and no one will know that happened. Oh, but man. literally, what happened there, folks at home, is we were just gone for 5 minutes. I could not reconnect to this GD hangout.
Dude, you're casing it up.
You know, folks, coming back here, we got a story from Melissa from Montana. Her dog just died, and she wanted me to shout out for her. Baby Got Back by Sir Mix-a-Lot. And that's coming up next on number 15. I don't know. Awesome. I don't even know what you even said. I don't know what I'm doing. I have no idea what I'm doing.
How awesome would it be to name a dog Sir Mix-a-Lot?
That's a good name for a dog.
Sir Wolf-a-Lot.
My girlfriend and I love coming up with just like really improbable pet names. I think my favorite is Paul for a cat.
Paul.
That's from Family Guy. Paul.
Wait, what?
Yeah, that Family Guy. Adam West has a cat crossbow. It shoots cats, and he's picking. And after he shoots after this guy, he's picking up his cats and putting them back in his bag, and he's like saying all their names, and he's like Paul. Paul, that's a ridiculous name for a cat, or something like that. I forget.
Damn it! I thought I was smart.
No, you watched that shit drunk, forgot, and
probably.
That's what went down.
Yeah. I've heard Adam West in real life is actually completely fucking insane. Like he did, I think he went to Comic-Con. He was doing a Q&A, but he would not enter. He refused to enter the building unless he was able to carry his sidearm. He actually had to get special permission to like come into Comic-Con armed.
That just seems fair.
He wouldn't do it.
Wait. Batman doesn't use guns.
Except for on all of his vehicles.
The apple has fallen far from the tree, Mr. Wayne.
Well, what do we think of Adam West Batman now? We think of that YouTube video where he's going...
That is a spectacular impression.
Wow. John, I did not know you could do impressions like that.
If you were like that, you'd need a gun, too.
Although I think that'd be the best way to go on stage ever. Just dress up as the old, like a 1960s Batman with that huge bomb making that sound, running up onto the podium.
Yes.
You'd have to be mic'd up. It all had to be, you know, planned.
You have to be coked up.
You have to, you know, clear the path.
Run all the way back. Go all the way around. Come back again.
Dude, it's
holy
like, sir,
white powder, Batman.
It's like, sir, what the hell are we doing again? Just shut up and do it.
Yeah. Chris, what are we talking about now?
I can't get that out of my head.
Can't get you out of my head.
Oh, no, I can't get that out of my head.
Here's this weird idea. You know, we were talking about Mars, but here's this weird idea that I had and I wanted to bring up just for fun, just to see where it goes. I have no idea if this even will go anywhere, this whole idea. The idea that NDAs – now, okay, like a non-disclosure agreement. What that means is you sign a fucking agreement whenever you do anything of a game company, so you're not talking about what you're doing because you might be using some new tech or you have got a bunch of games that are unannounced and they want to make sure timing is right for all that shit. They want to, you know, control those things. And that all makes a lot of good and well sense for an NDA. That's what it should be about. You shouldn't be running around, hey, guess what we're doing, guys? And, you know, that's what it's for. That's the purpose. That's the point. But I was saying, does it sometimes get dragged into a gray area where it can actually be negative to either the people involved, the developers themselves, or anyone at any level? If you look back to like those situations where when there's a major studio that has some major news about something about employees' grievances. Is it plausible, and there's been any situations where someone in charge kind of throws some shit at you as like, stop breathing your smoke into the microphone.
Sorry.
You filthy animal. But the situation that somebody might be abusing the idea of the NDA to abuse the employees.
I've been in a situation where, after the fact, when my studio was shut down, I had to sign an NDA agreeing never to tell anybody what I worked on ever for any reason, and I never even got the art assets I worked on from the game to show in my portfolio.
Right. I've had one of those where I had to sign the afterwards NDA where I don't go and bitch about being laid off. And
so that's
just to be
a,
just to clarify, that particular time I was laid off, I don't know, it was great. They were awesome. They gave me a nice severance. We gave us all, you know, it's awesome. That's the best layoff ever.
It's like, does the NDA cover telling you how awesome this is?
No, yeah, I didn't have to do that, but it was one of those things where they made you sign one to make sure you're not, you know, throwing your grievances out like, oh, I'm going right to Kotaku, you know.
Don't know anyone's done that recently.
Yeah. But it was still fine. It was actually great. It was one of the, like I said, I've been laid off plenty of times before where they're just like, oh, you're bye, get out, the end, nothing. But you know, they were super nice. Like I said, good severance and all that shit. So anyway,
oh no, I get paranoid to sign NDAs when I don't think I'm getting paid to work on a project.
Yeah, Brandon, remember that NDA we had to sign about coming into our homes when we were like, hell no.
Yep. That was the one we didn't sign.
Yeah, that's what, exactly.
I've noticed that, you know, like with all these layoffs and people losing jobs, there's been a lot of those types of NDAs come out. And I'm trying my best not to sign any of those.
Is that an initial NDA to talk about the project? Or is it the NDA that's included in the contract or employment agreement?
It's the NDA to talk about the project.
Yeah, it's
no, just
the
to see if
talking, the one we're talking.
Oh, okay, yeah, yeah.
No, the one we were talking about was the ability for the person to come into your house and go through your computer anything that the assets had touched.
Wow. Once we're offline, I'd love to know who that is. This is not the
no
place
comment.
To name and shame, but I'm curious.
Yeah.
Once I stop recording, we're gonna just be saying. We're just going to bury everyone.
Yeah, I'll just say like this. Some of these NDAs are FOS, and
you just
I think most people should start reading their NDAs, because there's some people trying to get you.
Yeah, never sign anything.
They're definitely trying to take advantage of you.
Yeah, never sign anything unless you've read it, and if you need, ask a friend, and because there's no NDA on the NDA.
Nope.
So don't sign it unless you understand it. I read every single thing I ever sign. I found some fucked up shit. There's one that someone was trying to get a friend of mine to sign based on the referral I gave, like that potential client to him. And into the NDA, just to talk about the project, they included a 2-year non-compete. So he couldn't work on any project that might be material similar in any way based on the discretion of that company, based on talking to them, the chance to talk to them. 2 years, which is completely insane. I got in a fight over it with that dude. I never heard from him again. So I tried to drill in, like, what's in it for him? Why would he sign away 2 years of control over his livelihood and career for the chance to talk to you? Like, if you're willing to pay, sure.
Right.
But, yeah, you got to read that shit.
It's becoming a reality. We've seen it more and more.
Yeah, that's why you read shit, and then don't be afraid to X something out. I had one contract with a client where if I had to agree to open all of my financial records for my company before, during, and for 2 years after the contracting agreement, all my financials for my company and all my other clients and everything, give them the ability to come to my house to audit me if they think that I overcharged them by more or less than 7%. If it's by more than 7%, or by house, place of business, whatever. If it's by more than 7%, I have to pay for the cost of the audit and all the people coming out, and then pay damages on top of that.
It's not even worth it.
I managed to negotiate that out because that's just fucking stupid.
But that's a situation where you're wondering how much money that company actually has and if they're going to actually be able to pay you at all.
I was like, why would you still... I'm guessing there was some real stuff that you didn't talk about, John, why you'd still want to do business with people like that.
I told them I would not do that under any circumstances, and they agreed. They also required me to carry... Well, they're also paying me extraordinarily well. I didn't have to do that. I negotiated out, and that was gone.
Maybe litmus test from you know, actually reading the contract. It's like, oh, it's a contractor who actually reads the contract. Maybe we actually want to do business with them.
I think in a way it was a test, but it was also a blanket agreement for all the different types of vendors in business that they're in. They weren't just a game company. They also wanted to require me to have, I think, $4 million of personal liability insurance in case I get hit by a car or whatever. And $4 million of insurance in case I fuck something up. There's $4 million of insurance that my insurance company will pay out to them, and I have to have that insurance the entire length of the contract and for 2 or 3 years beyond. I think that'd be about $50,000 a year I would have to pay.
Wow.
I negotiated that out as well. Everything's negotiable. But yeah, read what they want you to sign, no matter what. Like, even if you have to, most NDAs are 2 or 3 pages at most. I've seen them be 8 pages long. If you're sitting there in a studio, like signing an NDA before an interview or something, read every fucking word, make them wait as long as it takes for you to be comfortable with it and understand it, and don't do it under duress.
Some of that stuff you're mentioning just sounds like, you know, the corporate counsel they have on hand just saying, let's see how much wacky shit I can cram into this and see if no one notices. Like, we'll allow them, we'll get the guy to allow them to us to come to their house and audit all this shit.
Dude, even corporate lawyers sometimes don't read stuff. Like, I heard about a $20, $25 million AAA development contract where I kept going back and forth for so long. The developer who was negotiating with the publisher decided, you know what? I'm just going to put in the words banana, banana, banana into the middle of one of the parts that we're discussing. They never caught it, and they signed the contract. There's another person I heard of that worked at a publisher that would sneak in lines like, I own all of your firstborn. It's put that into dozens and dozens of contracts. It's never been noticed or called out. Sounds that'd like be a hell of a cash-in. Right?
Well, that big
7 days.
The evil contract lawyer from beyond the stars.
Banana, banana, banana.
I would not watch that movie.
Chris, when you brought this up, the first question that came to mind was, does anyone know someone, you know, on the game, not talking about big contract, not talking about developer, publisher kind of contract, but just individual developers. Have you ever heard of someone getting sued for one, for a game development contract?
Yeah, that's a really good point. I've actually, I feel like a lot of that stuff, they just don't go after. Like, I know there's been NDAs I've seen and heard of before where they'll have, like, these like non-compete clauses afterwards.
Right.
Where you're like, oh, you can't work on a game that's competitive, but then you do it anyway. Because it's like, you got to get a job. And if a place, I've heard of places, I've never had this myself, but I've heard of places saying, like, you can't work on something that is competitive in the next year. But if you are working on an MMO in a certain style, then you might get hired to work on MMO of the same stuff.
It's legally they're non-enforceable,
right?
But so let's say I've heard of one circumstance where a guy was going to a company making like different enough games. Honestly, he went and applied, and he was getting an offer, and the company he was leaving that had a non-compete in place with him called someone they knew at the company that was hiring him and bluffed and threatened to sue them, and the guy got his offer rescinded and then got fired. He had no job on either end.
Yeah,
Freddie, that's not legal. That's all back channel. But if you can't prove that, it's hearsay. You have no recourse individually, and that's scary. But legally, non-competes can't be enforced. You can just really fuck with people a lot. And my policy on non-competes is, if you work on Call of Duty and you're going to go work on Medal of Honor, I can understand there being like a one-year gap in there. I don't like it, but it makes a kind of sense, and that's something I would agree to as long as it's only 1 year. If they're that similar and that competitive, in that context, I can understand it. But if it's like 2 years or 3 years or something, or if it's broadly worded enough, my opinion is they should pay you for the time you can't work. And I haven't been in a situation where I've had to sign one like that, but believe me, I've had that saved up. If I ever am asked, I'm going to say, I don't see a part where you're going to be paying my salary for the time I'm contractually forbidden from working for anybody else. I've never heard of that working, but it's there.
Well, that's what I heard recently from a friend of yours, Dan McGackie.
Dan.
How in the movie business, there are, of course, we talked earlier, there are unions enforcing everything, but also they will do things like if you're expected to work only 9 months and then probably be off for three of that, you will probably get paid, your contract will have payment for 12 months. That's more endemic to the game and to movies than the game industry isn't quite there yet.
Yep, but it doesn't happen.
The movie industry has a whole economy based around movies that don't get made.
Which is amazing.
Yeah.
I think movies do it smarter in a lot of ways. And I think one of the fundamental problems is so often game developers, they don't know how to negotiate and they feel lucky enough to get a job, but they'll give up whatever rights they may or may not even be aware of that they're giving up just to score the gig.
Do you know what Hollywood people have that game industry people don't? Agents. Yeah. There's someone whose job it is who takes part of the money you would be making to represent you in contract negotiations.
At the executive level, they do have agents. It's just rare at the developer level. Technically, I have one, but I haven't had to call them in yet. But it is very, very rare. Like, just outsourced negotiation. It's smart. These people do it for a living. And in the discussion I was in with my agent, he was saying, okay, most of the time you just need to play dumb, act like, you know, okay, you know, I just want to be a good guy. I just want to do this, but I got to defer to my agent. It's sort of like good cop, bad cop, but it's more like bad cop, ignorant cop. But that's the way you have to play it. You have to have that antagonistic side of the relationship be external to you and have them handle your negotiation so that you don't seem like a dick. But I mean, it varies wildly. Negotiation's a funny game. But,
you are the one who's, you know, the one employee that they've sent an NDA to that had any kind of question to it, you get labeled a dick no matter what, just because you're asking too many questions.
Up to a certain point. But yes. up to a certain point. I mean, if it's just asking to explain something, or if you're clearly coming at it from the perspective of, look, I read everything and I'm just going to be a little bit of a troublemaker to show you, you can't fuck with me. If you have too much of a chip on your shoulder, it's just like, oh, you're a dick. But there are shades of gray. But yeah, I mean, you don't want to be a troublemaker, especially if you really want it. But yeah, it's.
I think you can also ask questions in the middle of it, just so they will know that you're trying to understand what is written.
Absolutely, and they're ready for that. If they don't have an answer, they'll find someone that does. In that situation, you're usually working with HR, which is a buffer for legal. And if they need, they can bounce questions back up to legal. And there's a reasonable midpoint in there. And something that just occurred to me, another example of what Chris has said that came up to me. An NDA really screwing somebody over. I don't know the exact laws and legalities of it, but so let's say, so when you're working on a game, making art for the game, you can't show off that art before it's been publicly released or before the game has been shipped unless you have permission. Technically, everything you do as a contractor or employee is work for hire, so the company owns everything you ever do. If a company wanted to be dicky enough about it, it's possible they could take you to court legitimately and prevent you from using anything you've done for them in your portfolio, even if the game has been released.
Yeah.
And I've seen that. I haven't seen the court part of that happen, but I know a guy that worked at a company for 5 years and just never updated his portfolio. Bad idea, because he was crunching the whole time, but just didn't take the time. He got laid off and then asked to have the assets he worked on, but they wouldn't let him have it. It was all the only stuff in his portfolio was over 5 years old, and he was out of work for like a year plus just because that company wouldn't give him his assets. And that's why you back your shit up every quarter. Which, again, is technically a gray area, but it's the kind of thing where if someone wants to be a dick, they're going to be a dick, but like 99% of people are cool about it. If a game's out, you can show your art. If there's any doubt, ask. But yeah, it always pays to back your shit up. It killed me seeing that happen to that dude.
Most definitely, no doubt.
It's a weird world, man.
I actually knew a guy here in town that had worked at Acclaim right before they went Chapter 7 on the game that they had all the way ready to ship, and then they never actually shipped it, called The Red Star. Eventually came out for the PS2, but what was fun is that he actually saved his stuff and put it out in his portfolio for a game that didn't come out until like a year later on a different publisher.
Was he in the credits?
I should look that up.
It's a great question. But see, that's another gray area. If your parent company is insolvent and the game's never coming out,
who's going to come after you, right?
But again, this is not legal advice.
actually, he did. So there you go.
Cool.
It still has developed by Acclaim Studios Austin, published by XS Games. But,
And that's cool. And one of my favorite stories about good credits is Duke Nukem Forever. They were in development for 14 years, and Gearbox acquired the IP and got the game, and with a small team of the original developers called Triptych, which are very underplayed, but they're the ones that helped finish the game and rock that out. Gearbox and Triptych got together to finish the game, and Gearbox put up a website asking for the information of every single person that ever worked on Duke Nukem in any way whatsoever, and put every single person they were able to get into the credits for the entire 14-year development cycle. And I thought that was amazing.
Yeah.
Gearbox are good dudes. I really respect what they do, and they earned a lot of my respect for doing that.
The least they could do, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it really is. But what other developers would really even take the time, you know? But for my part, working as a contractor, I mean, contractors and contract art studios usually get dicked and never get credit, and I'm used to it. But in the past couple years, I've started negotiating for that. Like, I'll ask that pretty early on, find out what the standards on credits are. I'll just ask flat out, can I be put in the credits? And except for, I've gotten a yes every time. Except for one where it's a social game and they don't have credits.
Yeah.
Which kind of sucks. But, yeah, always ask. Just even if you're a contractor, always ask. And you have the power. It's not a dick question to ask. It's just most people don't. This is one of those things.
Yeah. So it's always strange to me, as big a historian buff as I am, draw you all the way back to a game company called Atari, back when it was actually an American company trying to sound Japanese, as opposed to a French company trying to sound like a failed American company trying to sound Japanese. They did not originally credit any.
Damn it, John, I love you.
And the game, like four of the developers for the Atari 2600 broke off and formed their own company, and it was called Activision. And it was all about, we want credit for these games.
That's awesome.
But this is ancient history now. That's 30 years ago. Now, granted, you know, the dev team then was like usually just one or two people working on it. The E.T. the Extraterrestrial for the Atari 2600. Arguably the worst game ever made. Dev team won. I had to bang that out in like 2 weeks before Christmas.
Was that guy in the credits? Well, I guess he didn't want to be on that game.
Yeah.
I've a couple times I've asked not to be in the credits. if it pays the bills, man. But yeah, I've actually asked not to be put in the credits before, and there's some games I've worked on that I don't list professionally.
Alan Smithy, that's the term that Hollywood uses.
Yes. That's when you know. That's like the wild card for shit was fucked up. I don't want my name on it.
That's great. So, Alan Smithy. Yeah.
So, Chris, what do you think?
What do I think? Well, if you get to that position where you've had so many titles that you don't need them in your resume, then sometimes it's worth leaving a few of them out. Because you want to make sure it fits on one page, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah, that's purely space constraints, yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, sadly, I had to take off Ultimate Duck Hunting the other day. It's just time to move on.
I still leave on most of my early stuff, but Chris, there's one project. You and I both know the guy and have worked with him before. Small game. I think you know the one I mean.
I think I know what you're going for here.
Yeah.
This isn't the SpongeBob SquarePants game, is it?
No.
Dude, I worked on Sesame Street games. I played that up.
Yeah.
Because that shit was cool. It was a great experience. And actually, one thing that's really good on a resume is if you've worked on a licensed property, especially a relatively famous one, the owner of that IP is going to be very, very picky almost every time about how their characters and environments and gameplay and everything is represented. And they're very precise and very exacting. Like, when I was on the Sesame Street game, Cookie Monster had, I think, like 14 different types of chewing. And all the chewing had to correspond perfectly to one of those types. And when they're trying to promote the whole healthier living and anti-childhood obesity thing, every third thing he ate had to be a carrot or like some kind of vegetable. There's little things like that, even things that like affect gameplay and visuals. I've found it to be very good to have on my resume that I worked with a licensor like that. Was able to make the game and ship on time and work with this this external third party to make sure that we're living up to what they want their brand to be. Because I think that implies another level of discipline and difficulty in working on a thing. And I've played that the hell up. That's actually got me my biggest project ever that I was able to have had that experience. So for Chris, I'd say Warhammer. That is a massive plus.
Oh, yeah. It's a bullet point that Absolutely. People use to sell other companies I go to after.
Exactly. Everything is experience, and it's just about marketing yourself well. And one other thing I wanted to say about keeping the resume down to on only one page. If you've been in the industry for less than 5 years, if your resume is longer than one page, you're doing it wrong. I'm 11 and a half years in, and I've fit mine onto two. I think I've worked on like 30 different titles, but it's people not read past the second page. If you have a small amount of experience, like one page is going to be about the max. Like, don't put like, I worked at Subway or Kinko's in there unless it's literally your very first job in games. You're trying to get in on that. But yeah, never more than two pages ever, 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 ever. That's what I've been hearing my entire career. Never more than two pages. And I see so many people, it's like a guy with like 2 years of experience with a 5-page long resume. No one's going to read that. And it's going to be like, oh, God, look at this dick.
It goes right back to how so few people seem to know how to present themselves verbally or otherwise. And the resume is just another way to do that. Someone says, well, you got to put everything down. Well, I'm going to do absolutely everything. Well, sometimes it's not all that relevant to the job you're looking for.
Yeah, exactly.
The first person who's going to look at it is not going to be the people you work at. It's going to be the HR. You know, in the game industry, the HR people are, or if you have someone else who's not quite our HR but recruiting, they are the filter. They are the big filter for everything. They are the ones who keep, you know, the unworthy away from the actual people who have to interview. And yes, they will not put up with a five-page resume. They won't look at it.
Exactly. They have so many resumes to go through in a day. And if you can, like, whittle irrelevant stuff out, like, you know, if you're a drug dealer and you're trying to doll it up by saying, yes, I was a freelance pharmacist for 4 years, just leave that off.
And I was the muscle, so I have security experience.
I respect security policies.
Here's a question I have, though. Have you ever encountered someone who actually cared about what you were doing for some period of time in your life? That seems to be a disconnect for a lot of people who write their own resumes. Well, I want them to know what I was doing there. They don't care.
Before or between?
Well, I suppose if there's a long gap in between big deal projects, I suppose they could just ask you, but is it important enough to put on a resume?
I'd say if it's a gap for longer than maybe like 6 or 8 months, try and find something. Even if it's just like mod experience or just doing stuff for fun, then I just include that in there, but keep it ultra short. Sure. And just say, you know, like contract artist or something like that. You know, worked with, you know, a character's environments, use these software packages, just keep it like 2 or 3 lines at most. I know for long enough gaps between jobs, you will get asked. Or if you worked at a company for a short enough amount of time, you will get asked. Or like, serially.
Right. Well, I mean, you could get asked, but is it the kind of thing that keeps you from even getting to the point where you interviewed? I think that'd be something people might worry about.
If it's, I'd say if it's like over a year or a year and a half between things, that's going to be a red flag. But if it's a short enough amount of time, and I feel like it's going to be a lot more lenient lately in games just because of all the layoffs and all the bullshit, I think people will be a lot more forgiving.
Sure.
But if it's longer than a year, yeah.
Because, I mean, especially now that we're diversified in what makes a game project, there are a lot of projects that are even less than a year and they're supposed to be. You know, if you're working much longer than a year on a Facebook game, you wonder why. You know, or even some mobile games, you better be able to turn those out pretty quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, they have dev cycles of anywhere from like 1 to 4 months. For stuff like that, well, if you're employed at one company, yes, list out everything you worked on at that company and keep that under that heading. Don't split it out unless you got a major title change, like from junior to senior or something like that. Right. But I wondered for a while what to do as a contractor, because so I do art outsourcing and I'm usually not needed for a full project. My involvement may only be like 2 to 4 months. If I were to list out every single thing like that, the resume would get really long and I'd look like a job hopper. But If you put that under the heading of like contract artist or like under the heading of my company Smartest, I list the different clients I worked for and maybe, you know, 2 or 3 of the games I worked on under that particular heading. And I think that minimizes how weird that might look, just having a bunch of super short term things on.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
That's an answer.
It is an answer, but John, was it good?
Sure.
I'm so insecure.
It's not like I got cards up. I can just hold up 10. The Olympics are over.
It's like, hey, you can see the length of an answer for a question.
Yeah. No, it's not the gong. You know, Chris isn't, you know, hopped up to his gills on cocaine or whatever the hell that host was.
The Chuck Barris. Have you seen that movie?
No, but I know what you're talking about. He was high every show.
Oh God, I bet.
Yeah, I mean, like, well, just look at the shows. He's just like, "Hi, everybody! Wow, it's a great show."
he's probably coming down off like a hit.
Yeah, well,
not a hit. I mean, just like off of killing somebody.
It was the 70s. Yeah. They popped over to Studio 54 and like inhaled the, you know, the amyl nitrates they put into the is the air conditioning.
Is this like the guy from Laughing?
Well, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, Chuck Barris. Confessions of a Dangerous Mind is a movie about that dude, starring Sam Rockwell, directed by George Clooney. It's sort of like an Ocean's 11Z style story of that guy's career on The Gong Show and Laughing, I think. But supposedly he was a contract serial killer for the government as well. So whenever they'd go to like a weird locale to do the show, he was there for a fucking hit. And he alleges that this was actually fucking true. And the movie is based on, you know, if that was true, this is from him more or less what went on with the Hollywood treatment. It's a really fun movie, Confessions of a Dangerous Mind.
I need to see this movie.
Check it out. Oh, it's cool. Yeah.
I love Sam Rockwell too. So
he's incredible. He's here. I thought that in the Hitchhiker's Guide movie, which was terrible, I thought that the only other person on Earth that could do Zaphod Beeblebrox would be Bruce Campbell. But I was pretty happy with how Sam Rockwell did.
I walked out on that movie.
That's a good idea.
I'm starting to believe that I'm the only person that liked that movie.
Have you read the books?
I haven't read the books, but I've seen the original BBC series as well.
Oh, okay.
So, I walked out when they blew up the Earth. It's like it's
like 2 minutes in.
Like, that's an important event in the movie, and you can't make me interested in the Earth blowing up. It can't get any better than that.
It's like, Michael Bay or not, sir, I say good day.
You lose. I'm out.
It's like, I fell asleep in the middle of the Earth exploding. What's wrong?
Yeah.
Damn it.
Like, this isn't even, like if there's, like, a Turkish take on this, that'd be funnier and more interesting. That goes without saying.
I'm starting to think that all movies made today kill everyone's childhood.
I think so. Dude, Ninja Turtles being aliens in Michael Bay's next movie?
What? No.
Well, that's not happening.
Canceled.
Yeah. Was it? Thank God.
Let me present this to you, Mr. Brandon Bruce. Is it really killing childhood?
Actually,
or are you just getting older?
I think I'm just because
I've been feeling that myself. The older I get, the more I'm like, back in my day. But then I realize that's stupid.
I do that for music. I do it for cartoons. I do it with comics.
I don't like what people are doing now because it's different a little bit, maybe.
Nothing can beat Rainbow Bright in Wham.
What?
Did you say Wham?
Wham.
Take me up before
She-Ra
you go.
She-Ra and Strawberry Shortcake were my favorite things.
Fucking polio did.
I didn't hear the first half of that. Would it be funny or not to?
Yeah, all I heard was polio did. I think that's all it might have picked up, but I don't know.
I like taters.
They hear they're remaking that with Sean William Scott.
What?
That's not true.
Sean William Scott is remaking the movie Clown that Drafthouse Films here in Austin actually picked up. It's this Danish film that's like something like if either Curb Your Enthusiasm or It's Always Sunny in California.
Philadelphia.
Philadelphia was crossed between with Lauren Hardy and Eurotrash and a lot of man ass.
What the fuck?
That's what this movie is. It's called Clown, spelled with a K. And it's just two dudes making really horrible decisions. And it's really fucked up and raunchy. But it's hilarious. You can see it now at the Alamo Draft House.
Nice.
Is it about the ICP?
No, that's actually coming. Well, actually, I saw that on Vimeo today. American Juggalo.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah, I saw that documentary.
Here's a worse one. John DeLancey is going to the guy who played Q on Star Trek is going to host and actually was producing BronyCon the movie.
What?
Yeah. He went to the conference of people who love the new My Little Pony show and did a movie about it. This is coming out. It was kickstarted.
Oh my God.
Okay, this is a serious question. What the hell is, like, so freaking hot about My Little Pony? Because I remember it as a child, you know.
Yes. Okay.
I
think I can actually be objective about this, because I've watched enough to realize that it was not...
I could be objective about My Little Pony. I'm sorry, that was great. Please keep going.
So, wait. This is live. This is live that John Henderson likes My Little Pony.
This is live that I liked it enough to appreciate it for what it is. It is not for me. I think it's entertainment enough for everyone, including 7-year-old girls who buy little plastic toys. But this show was made well enough that their mommies and their daddies can appreciate it. However, crazy people on the internet fuck everything up. Yes, it had been 20 years since there had been a My Little Pony show on TV, but then, like, The Hub, which replaced Discovery Kids on the cable channel, basically got, well, here's another thing. Hasbro's got this wild hair lately about licensing their toy properties to cartoonists that actually know what they're doing. In this case, they got Lauren Faust, who's the wife of the guy who created the Powerpuff Girls, and she wrote the script for the Powerpuff Girls movie, and she was a fan of the original My Little Pony show. So it has charm, and it has characters that are actually identifiable. So in that sense, it's a fine show. Everything on the internet about it, fucked up.
How do you know all this?
I looked this shit up.
I mean, I feel like
I'm not knocking it. I
watch
it
every day on Cartoon Network.
I watch it four episodes. I've watched 4 episodes of it all the way through.
Well, lucky for me, the internet exists, so I could look up a childhood memory that was just locked back there in the brain. Totally forgot about it until we just started talking about My Little Pony. Because I grew up, you know, I was born in 1979. My sister was born in 1977. So I grew up with all that 80s shit.
Yep.
And I specifically remember My Little Pony, the movie, which, thank you, Wiki, 1986 was when it was released. And I remember this whole fucking movie. For some reason, I just remember it in my head. Because my sister had all the My Little Ponies. Like, I had all the He-Mans and the Transformers. And she had all the My Little Ponies and the Barbies. And so whenever she watched those movies, I remember always watching with her just because I was 5. You know what I mean? Like, I was a little kid.
Oh, yeah.
But now this whole redux that they've done with it, for some reason, I think it's the style, the animation's pretty adorable, the way they're, you know, they're kind of like
wacky. Is that, the voice acting is excellent.
Yeah,
everything
is really just well done, and it's one of those things like a... It's kind of like SpongeBob in the fact that adults can get into it, but nobody really wants to admit that they're getting into it.
Okay, Chris, I have to ask. That's the other animation, SpongeBob. I cannot get into that. I don't know.
Yeah, well,
I'm getting old. I think that's what it is. I'm old.
The guy who created SpongeBob.
Brandon, you're a very mature 16.
I'm just a big Tom Kenny fan.
I have another trivia moment, if you let me say it. The guy who created SpongeBob SquarePants, Steven Hillenburg, is a marine biologist.
See there?
Wow!
You know, I really like that. What was the Adventures of Flapjack? I love that one. That was dope.
Oh, okay.
I'm just letting the marine biologist thing settle. That's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Who lives in a pineapple under the sea? Who could tell you more about it than this guy?
Yeah.
So do you guys learn anything when you watch SpongeBob?
I don't understand why Krabby Patties are burgers.
Wait, what?
Where do they get that beef? That comes from a cow.
They've had whole episodes about putting weird shit on the Krabby Patties. Like at one point they put jellyfish jelly on it, and it became addictive like a drug.
Okay, now I can see how it's funny. That's Krabby Patty.
That was his job. He's a fry cook. Yeah.
And how does that work?
How do you fry things underwater? Great question.
Maybe he knows. The amount of research that went into the show is staggering.
Well, I'm glad we're not talking about My Little Pony anymore, but I'm not afraid to have said that I can appreciate it for what it is.
And
there's nothing wrong with that.
Well, I would kind of reference it to remember Powerpuff Girls?
Yeah. Actually,
like, how dope was Powerpuff Girls? How dope was that fucking show?
Yeah, it was awesome.
Mojo Jojo.
I am the Mojo Jojo.
I do not talk about that.
That's it. The Van Devil of your sassy mouth.
Originally, that show was called The Whoop-Ass Girls. It wasn't...
Oh, yeah.
It was the final ingredient to create the perfect little girl, sugar, spice, and everything nice. And then Professor Utonium added whoop-ass. But they decided not to call it that.
That's awesome.
It's good they went with the blank choice of Chemical X.
Which is whoop-ass.
And then the next show he did for Cartoon Network was Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends.
That show was fucking insane.
You know, oddly enough, another amazing show, Strangers with Candy. The main character is named Jerry Blank because they were trying to make a good joke, a good fucking name, what her last name was, so it was literally just a blank space.
Oh, yeah.
And they ended, they just went with it. They just kept it. So her name was, that's why the main character is named Jerry Blank.
Nice.
And actually, guys, I had a question that's a little bit more on topic. Chris had a list of topics for the show. What do you guys think of 4D in games in gameplay space?
I'd first have to ask you, what is 4D in games?
That's a good question.
I'd like to hear your interpretation, Brandon.
4D in games. So I'm guessing it's a game that makes me think.
Travel through time!
Yes.
Is that like
we're taking a journey through my mind.
Is that like the Kinect or something?
Yeah, that's when you jump around like an idiot in front of your TV.
Yeah,
there is a recognition lag.
What is 4D? What is the fourth dimension?
It's where you're
is
all
it time?
Making...
It's heart.
Is it Blink's the Time Sweeper for Xbox?
Double down on doubly do right.
But see, 4D in games in gameplay space. That's the real question. John, what do you think?
Is that when you're all just making Hypercube, Tesseracts, and Maya?
It can be anything you want. How do you feel about it?
What is the fourth dimension to you, Dr. Sir John Henderson?
I don't actually have answers to this. I actually think that the human language is best when it is not an impediment to understanding.
Oh.
It's better when we have words that have meaning.
That's
Philosophicast.
Yeah.
As far as what the fourth dimension means to me, I'm going to need a little time to mull that over.
Cool.
and there goes
look at
John
just disappears into the night. And then he turns on the
John
kitchen
is
light.
In the
he just He's went the to the fourth dimension. You and me, Brandon. You can't see it because I don't have video, but you and me, like, little, you know, pointing each other's eyes thing. That's what I'm doing right now.
High five.
So, Chris, what the fuck do you think you could possibly have meant when you wrote that down? 4D in games, in gameplay space?
I know that I was in the middle of a discussion, but I totally forgot it because it was really late at night, and I was right about to go to sleep, and I came up with this idea, and I just wrote it down and just saved it. And that's what happens with a lot of things that you write down. You always want to write down everything. That's very important. You need to write down everything. You need to keep a text file on your desktop that you can pop up at any time and just drop in an idea. The downside is translating it 8 hours later after a night's sleep. That's where you're going to run into the details. But yeah. What does that even mean, 4D in games, in gameplay space?
I don't know, but I'm
going
impressed.
With the idea of time. And there was recently... Oh, shit. What I got to do is...
John, what the fuck?
Is this Silent Hill? Is that Slender Man? Look, Slender Man, oh no! Let's see what he does next. There's his milk. There's Bailey's. I got Bailey's. I got everything nice. I got Bailey's. I'm old Greg.
Oh, Greg. Come get some of this milk and sausages.
Old I've got Greg. The funk.
Uh, This has actually been one of our more focused shows, I think.
Yeah, we stayed. The best part of this show is we stayed 100% on topic, and we've we've never strayed off. We've been straight on it, like a precision, like a doctor. It's probably the best show ever.
I think so too. So, yeah, our topics, we really hit them. And Chris, I think you smell very nice.
I need to trim my pits, but I appreciate you being nice.
We have credits in games. We appreciate My Little Pony on a deeper level. And we feel very deeply about 40 games in gameplay space.
Oh, yeah.
It's really very important, heady topics.
Really important thing. And I'm really glad we put so much depth and detail into the discussion about the way 40 in games and gameplay space really makes it's a huge topic. It's a very controversial topic, but it's really the future of the industry, and people are starting to understand this with all these new games that are coming out that we all discussed before. The titles, I'm not going to repeat everything that we talked about, but
actually
if you just go back a couple minutes here, and then you listen to the previous discussion that we had, and you'll understand everything you need to know about 4D in games and gameplay space. And hopefully we can move on to the fifth dimension or six. I hear there's 10 to 8, I don't know, maybe 12 dimensions.
This next generation, baby.
Yeah,
that's
really what's going to happen next. And the best part about the discussion we had was that's information that people have to know. If you don't know that information about 4D in games in gameplay space, then you're pretty much fucked. You can't get a job. You can't get a job because you don't know how 4D in games in gameplay space works. And that's what the next gen is.
The movement. Games are going to be in 3 years.
The next version of the Xbox, next version of the PlayStation, that's what it's all about. And if you didn't listen to that part that we talked about earlier, then it's going to be very difficult for you to move forward.
Yeah,
as an artist, any title in the industry, even in marketing.
Even, no more AAA games. Yeah. They're all going to be 4D.
But actually, one thing I wanted to say was, who didn't weigh in on that subject? Lee.
I'm sorry, I was busy 4D-ing on Chris.
Well, Lee is very, he's definitely working. Lee is working in the fourth dimension right now.
I'm in the zone. I haven't done level design in so long. Man,
he's pandering at the highest level right now.
I am.
By using my
set,
my stupid UDK set that I released, there's a lot of fucked up shit about it. I admit it, but no big deal. I did it in a weekend. Fuck you. Release a whole UDK level, custom assets in a weekend. Do it. Do it. I'm daring you.
The gauntlet has been laid down.
I'm daring you to release an entire custom UDK level on a weekend. Anyway,
is
sorry.
Is it possible, Chris, that you wanted to talk about that studio out of Nebraska called 4D Rulers that made the game Gore?
Not really. Earlier, John made a reference to it.
And then
he didn't go into the story. Remember when he was... Remember earlier? It was about... Oh geez,
James, we don't.
It was 50 minutes ago. 50 minutes ago, John Jones said, "Hey, you remember that guy that we worked with? When you know him?" And then he went into some other topic and didn't talk about that story at all. So I'm kind of curious what that story was.
God damn you!
you know what I'm talking about, right?
The Secret Service security breach.
Oh yeah, that was a dope game, bro.
It was the very first game
to use the next-gen technology.
Before Abe's Odyssey on Xbox?
Before Doom 3.
Beat it to market. It was not a good game. It was not a pretty game. I got paid to work on it, and that was cool. And I don't include that on my resume. It was just... It was a game that needed maybe 10 to 12 months. We got six. Had like five people working on it. I mean, what's the best you can do like that,
Yeah, let's be honest about it. The whole game was a very simple game, but by a very, very small team. Very small team. Under very tight constraints. And you can't really say the studio or the people behind it were wrong. Because it was just one of those situations where the publisher says, make this in this amount of time, and this is the project we're giving you. Fuck you. And it's, I mean, obviously the people involved weren't, going to get the best result you could get out of a different team, but...
And John, yes, I am watching you.
Dude, John is going crazy. I'm switching him. But you know, you have to understand it was a very, very small company, very small team, very small budget, all that kind of shit. So they were kind of, they were pretty much fucked from the start, kind of project. But the, so the game wasn't that great, and oddly enough, it was at a studio I was at. I got a cough. I'm gonna mute my mic. What are those? What are those shavers? What are you holding up? Shavers? Those are shavers. That's why he's such a hairless man. He's got all these shavers. No.
Someone say that's his best quality.
Fun fact: John Henderson has no hair on his body.
I've checked.
Fun fact, but Jesse Sosa gonna come back. All right.
Okay. So here's the weird thing. Was
and by the way, Chris, I'm doing a screen share of screenshots of Secret Service security breach.
I'll put those up when I see them. Oh, there they are. Maybe. So what happened was I worked at the studio and I built an art library. For me, I felt that a studio should have an art library, like a bunch of things that you could reuse, like very high resolution things like trees and stuff, like leaves that you could always reuse, even though, you know, every project needed to be unique. So you want to have custom stuff and you want it to be as custom as possible. But I felt that it's very important to build up these libraries of art that you can still go back and reference to or use at a later date. Team work is what they call it.
Right.
So what happened was when I worked on the previous game for this company, a lot of the textures, I came up with this process of building the textures as high poly meshes in 3D Studio Max.
Good policy.
And this was back
fucking 03?
This was way no. 03. What are you talking about? This is before the year 2000.
Oh, that's right.
This is before the year 2000. This is before the world ended. Think the fucking Y2K fucked up everything. It destroyed the world, and we're living in this Mad Max post-apocalyptic Fallout 3 is what we're living in right now. This is what it's like right now. If you're listening to this podcast, you know. But no, long story short, I didn't feel like I was above my time because I saw all these other people doing like what were they doing? I've looked at what they were doing in movies. Like what are they doing in like high-end shit? So most of the textures I made for that game I made in 3D Studio Max as high detail meshes. I would start a texture with what I called the base scene, which had all my lights already set up so that when I bake everything out, it was good to go. And it was just diffuse maps. That's all we had was diffuse maps. So what happened was I had this huge art library of high poly assets then, and I left the company because they just weren't doing anything. Team of mediocrities? What are you looking here? 40-year-old? What are you trying to do here? What are you trying to do here?
I thought it was funny.
So what happened was, for those that are just listening to the audio, John was just putting up some unfortunate reviews of the project. But what happened was I had this huge amount of high detail meshes just ready to go. It was my art library I built for the company, and high detail bakes, high detail source art, everything was like super high. Like, and this was at a time when you're baking out your textures of 128s.
Baking high?
Baking. You painted it 128. You didn't even bake. No one baked back then.
No, I was just saying, like, here's like everything was high.
We were high as shit. Baked. No, it was Nebraska. No one did anything.
They'd never
all they
me.
Did was you like corn. Like drunk drive, crash, and kill their wife.
Nebraska.
Nebraska.
Jesus, man.
Cornhuskers. Woo! Go Big Red. Go Big Red.
Oh, God. Fuck those
anyway,
guys.
Long story short, all this asset library I built of high detail meshes ended up being in that game, Secret Service. They just took the meshes I had and stuff and just baked out normals. I never baked out normals because normal maps did not exist when we were working on that previous game.
Inconceivable.
And so what happened was that they literally just had all these fucking high detail assets ready to go, and they baked them all out and made a fucking game. Now there's a ton of custom shit that wasn't mine, but there's a lot of stuff. If you compare the two games, you can say, oh wait, that's the same thing, but there it is with a normal.
But yeah, well, you reused the hell out of your assets.
I don't think that's wrong. I think that I applaud that. That's what game studios should
do. I wasn't apologizing.
It's great. No, no, you're not. You're not. I'm just saying I believe in building asset libraries. That's why I did it for that studio. It shouldn't be every little thing you make. Like, if you're making a bush or a tree, how many games could that go in? A ton of them. Obviously, you're going to have the style differences. Like, say, oh, this is a different... Like, say, if you're doing a game... If you made a game, like a some fantasy MMO versus sci-fi horror, obviously, you're not going to be sharing any assets. Possibly...
Sci-hormo.
Possibly a Starfield. But besides that, yeah.
This bush isn't sci-fi.
This bush is not sci-fi enough. It's not...
It needs more tech.
What I noticed looking closely at the screenshot of the cover art to the Secret Service game is that it was published by Activision Value Publishing.
Yep.
Activision Value.
Well, I love that they weren't the only ones doing it either. That THQ had their section ValueSoft, which I think is so is not defunct. I love the idea of using the word value in that way. It's like...
It's like you're at the grocery store.
Right, exactly.
And like, oh, wait. Let me get these fucking spaghetti noodles. Wait. On the shelf below that is spaghetti noodles _value. And they're only... And they're a dollar less.
Bottom shelf.
Yeah.
You can buy them by the pallet at Big Lots.
That's actually where most of the sales of that game came from.
I can believe it. You can buy games at Big Lots. I've seen them on... Once I saw Daikatana on a rack at
Big Lots. Oh, God. By the way, it's totally random. Big Lots, one of the things I love the most about them was my girlfriend has a terrible Christmas gift exchange every Christmas with her family. Right, and we found, I think, like Pope John Paul for Dummies. Which I think was the funniest concept for a book I've ever fucking heard.
Yeah, the weird thing about that is, isn't that redundant?
I've seen Christianity for Dummies, yes.
That's redundant, right?
See, that's why I'm hardline Islam.
Nice. You're like 100% like full Shiite. Like, your dirt, like your girl doesn't go out of the house without like a big black tarp over her whole body.
Wears almost entirely black, but... It's funny the extent to which all of you know that is not true.
Yeah. You run beer nights because you're, so devout.
You know, the funniest part for those with video, those on YouTube or Vimeo, which I need to re-update my account, only see everything that John Jones says as this picture for the screenshot from Secret Service because he left it up.
Yeah. No, I didn't leave it up. I just closed screen share on that.
Oh, it just hasn't updated.
I'll find something better.
Yeah.
Okay, what year did the game come out?
Dude, what you should do is open up that link I sent you earlier that had all the animal gifts, all the cats and like horses and dogs.
Dude, I was totally going in that direction.
Because that shit is hilarious. Like, what's better than... a page, a website that has all it is just GIFs or GIFs for those that don't know how to
pronounce it correctly.
It's just like cats like falling down or dogs like trying to jump over something and like whoops, they fucked up. Derp. But yeah, they're fine. But it's just humorous because they're terrible at it.
Is this one any better?
Yeah.
Oh, the accordion kitten. That's pretty good.
He's crushing the cat.
This is the only thing I'm going to display for the entire rest of the cast.
I just realized that my level I just made, if you're not good at double jumping, you're pretty fucked.
That's a good level.
Barrier to entry. I'm going to grab a beer real quick. I'll be right back. Enjoy
the
kitten. Yeah,
that's the downside of dealing with that the UDKs. I was going to say that Unreals.
John left us with kitty porn.
These assets do snap together well. I must congratulate you on that.
Well, it's all built on the grid. It's very... The whole thing's really overly simple, but I feel like it's possible to still make something pretty complicated, especially if you get custom with it if you want to.
Looks like one of the side-scrolling levels from Super Mario 64.
No, it does not. Shut up.
Except it's very shiny, and Mario doesn't have shiny.
Yeah.
Well, it's the new Super Mario Brothers 64.
Two. I like that you use crates as supports.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out...
You caulked those trims with crates.
Yeah. I was trying to find interesting ways to break up the geometry.
I appreciate that. That's one thing I've talked about with a lot of people. I say one of the most interesting things about making, say, like some textures. Back in the days when you made art, you made some textures, and then it was given to level designers who used BSP as creatively. Wait for John to get his headset back on. Wait, Jesse just joined again.
Hold on, Jesse's in.
Wait, Jesse's here. Jesse's back.
You better have some fucking clothes on, asshole.
He's got a green shirt. Yeah, I bet it's a Polycount shirt or some bullshit like that.
Jesse's her.
I have clothes on now.
Hey, Jesse, why don't you pierce some Jesse's shit? Her.
Dude, awesome.
Jesse's her.
Are you guys still recording or what?
Yeah, it's still going.
What? Shit, how long is this thing going to be?
Ever.
Party's just getting started. Jesse's here.
Welcome to the Jesse Sosa podcast.
Hey, so no,
hold on, real quick.
No, we're not gonna just stop talking for you.
Yeah, you're right. Like making, I think it helps that I was a designer before I was an effects artist, and I can. You know, because we would get models from the environment artists, and I just have to start making stuff and saying, oh, you know, that would look really cool if I rotated it this way, made it a little bigger.
Yeah, back to what I was saying was, like, it was the idea that back in the days, all you had was brushes. You had very simple meshes that you built the whole environment out of. And it was a very short time in 3D video game development that existed, because they quickly jumped into saying, like, things like static meshes or, like, a model that you built. Is dropped in and used. But point is, it was always exciting as an artist to see, I made this texture and, you know, I put my love into it or whatever. But when you see a level designer take that and use it on a brush in some creative way that you never thought about. And that's the interesting thing is when you release assets and people start using it, like you do an SDK, you do like a character model. Really nice UVs, very, very, very custom allowing kind of mesh. And then you see the creativity. Is that a weird way of pronouncing that word?
Not
creativity.
Really.
Yep. When you see that, it's such a sense of, I don't know, maybe, I don't want to say accomplishment, but a sense of like, okay. This person is excelling artistically based on something incredibly creative they came up with this random stack of things that I said, here, use these. Like, it's like you build, like, imagine building your own custom set of Legos and giving it to somebody, and they build something that you've never even imagined they would build.
And that's amazing.
I feel like that's something that's... Just, a nice gift, John. He's the turtle falling. Who's about the benefit of video right now? John currently has a looping GIF of a turtle falling face down.
My caption for that is "World's Nakedest Skydiving Accident."
That's one thing John does is very interesting. One thing John does that everybody loves is he'll link something. But give it a caption that's nowhere near an accurate description. It'll be like, he'll be like, not safe for work. Horrifying train wrecks into school bus full of children. And you click it, and it's a kitten laying on its back, asleep, dreaming, and it's like pawing at the air. And that's the kind of thing that John likes to do.
Did you guys see what I posted at the very beginning of the chat?
Oh, sorry. I was in the zone.
No, it's all good. I had three really good ones I was proud of.
Libyan Village Massacre?
Yes.
I got that, yeah. It's the bathroom.
So, you know, all jokes aside, hey, Jesse, what are you up to? It looks like you're eating a burrito.
I'm just eating a salad real quick.
It's a salad I knew he was eating. Woo, nailed it.
Salad it. Burrito. At least you have clothes on.
For the not first easy, time ever. Hey, where's David that cat? Hasselhoff in it.
It's not my fault if I just want to bring a little bit of excitement to the cast. I'm sure you guys are talking about 3D or something.
No, we're talking about 4D. Oh, hey, Jesse. Here's a very, this is a very serious topic we had earlier, and you weren't here, but I would like to get you into it because I know you're a really smart person. I really respect you as an artist because, you know, I think you're amazing. I think you're smart. I think you're intelligent. I need the post that you make, like when you did that one post about the characters and you broke down the whole modular character design is amazing. You're just like one of the smartest people, and I think that, you know, before you just recently changed your portfolio, I always thought, what's that noise? Oh, it's you're chewing. You're chewing fucking salad. Thank you. I thought you were like, I respected you so much as like one of the best portfolios I'd ever seen. I would tell anybody that say go to skanker0.com and this is the template of what a portfolio should be, but now you've recently changed it and it's also amazing. And you know your art's great, and you've transitioned between the movies. You know you're one of the best artists in the. I think of you as like you know I highly respect you as one of a great artist. So I want to ask you.
Thank you.
So here's the question, and I feel like I've prefaced this question in the most proper way. What do you think about 4D in games in gameplay space?
4D as in as used as a gameplay mechanic?
Yeah, you know, sure, whatever you think about it. Like, what are you thinking about right now when you think about that? Probably thinking about croutons and bacon.
No. I just got spinach and carrots.
Lacey is not asking about My Little Pony.
Man, I kind of wish I would have heard everyone else's discussion on that because, I mean, it's kind of an open-ended question. I mean, we already are playing in the 4D. I mean, fourth dimension is time.
Yeah,
so
okay. So they you accept the fourth dimension is time. That's one of the questions because sometimes people think of it as something different than that. But yeah, no. I usually think of 4D as time.
Mm-hmm. We live in the fourth dimension. Because I mean. As you play your FPSs, I mean, things move along in time and all that. Now, if you don't start getting to some string theory bullshit, then that's when things start getting interesting. But,
oh, yeah.
You know, it just requires you to wrap your mind around the fifth and sixth dimensions. And I think, actually, it really starts getting interesting around, what is it, the seventh or eighth dimension. I think that's when it really starts getting all kinds of crazy.
You know, I brought up the game Blinks the Time Sweeper.
But yeah, if you're talking about utilizing time as an element of gameplay in terms of like a, I don't want to say like a Prince of Persia, but if you are controlling two characters that, you know, one in the past sets up events for the one in the future and stuff like that, then I could see where that that kind of stuff is pretty interesting. It's damn. But it's... I don't know. What was the discussion about? Like, what were you guys talking about?
It was very heady, very philosophical.
Yeah.
Brandon, are you okay?
I'm fine. He's like watching his gift and Joan has a...
For those about the benefit of photography, for those of you that you're listening to the audio, you're not watching the tapes. You're not watching the video. You're not watching the VHS copy of this. So you got video. You're just listening to the cassette tapes or the 8-tracks. What John is currently looping is the GIF of the little girl that is riding on like a fire truck, like a tiny little toy. It rolls, and she's riding on it. You know, like toddlers have these toys, like a big wheel, but less than that. And this corgi comes out of nowhere and fucking nails the kid, knocks it right over, it kills it.
And the
child is dead. The child is dead. And the corgi celebrates his success in murdering a small child. And I'm pretty sure it's really easy to Google this GIF. What do you call that? How'd you find that fast so fast? Would you just go to Reddit? You just went to Reddit and clicked an image link?
Dude, you have no idea how many GIFs I have saved on my hard drive.
Well, I remember it was several years ago, many, many years back. God, probably it could have been a decade ago that you confided in me. You came to me because you're like, you know, like I respect you and you're, you know, somebody I trust and all that stuff. And you confided in me and you said, Nick, I'm really upset about this. And you said, all the gifts I have are porn. So it's great that you've, you know, you've come a long way, that this isn't pornography at all. This is just a dog killing a child.
By the way, Jesse, that's a great look for you.
Yeah, he's got one of those effects. What is that? Google effects?
Yeah. And by the way, Chris, as you know, for the posterity of all, the absolute funniest thing in the world to me is watching children get hurt.
Oh, John loves that. You remember that link I sent you? I sent you that link recently. I was like, "You'll LOL at this," and it was a child falling three stories off an escalator to the. Because it's a horrible.
Serious.
You go to its own live link. It's like a some kid. He goes up to it. I'll describe the scene for you. And when you really watch it, there's an inherent amount of humor about it, and the fact that it's a horrible thing happening is a tragic for the family. But what's really going down here is, it's a kid. He just run. There's two women, and they've got the kid with them. The kid, he's a little boy. He just runs up to the escalator ahead of them, so he's already got the advance. And he grabs the escalator because he knows that he can grab onto it and like it'll pull him. So he grabs onto the escalator and it picks him up. And then John's got some gifts and girl on. Jesus. So it lifts him up in the air. And you know, the kid on his own is doing fine. But what happens is the two women run over. And I feel like the second woman, the one that's farther to the right, kind of runs over so fast that she pushes him off. I feel like that's what happened. And it's an accident because she's running, you know, she's running full tilt. She's obviously not prepared to rescue a child. And she's running full tilt, and the kid just falls right off. And then it cuts to the second camera, which is on the second floor, because they're on the third floor. They're on the top floor, the third floor. He falls down, and you see it just go, whoosh, just like swish by the camera. And he's clearly a kid. And then you see the bottom level, where it's like, and he just smacks on the floor, and it's really horrible. It's a horrible video, but this is what John Jones just laughs at. This is what he when he sees a kid getting hurt, as you can see based on this looping GIF that I have for some reason left on the video. For those of you that have the benefit of video of a girl who's maybe 7 or 8 years old dying. She's falling down the stairs, and that's it. That's over. It's the end.
Just
I think
hurt,
what we need
man.
To do is I'm going to switch. I'm going to switch over to Brandon Bruce because he looks very welcoming. He looks very inviting. He looks like a teddy bear. You just give him a hug. He's going to take care of you. You can find comfort in his masculine big man chest, ladies out there.
Oh yeah.
Wait a minute. Are you single? What's going on? I'm trying to put you over.
Yeah.
I hear you've been looking for the ladies.
Yeah, come on down here and come on down to the fourth dimension. That's right, I like to do the game thing, the playing thing.
Neil Strauss up in this motherfucker.
That's right. They call me cowboy.
It's funny when white guys say motherfucker.
you gotta say it with some bass.
I like what's happening right now. Might be the best part of the show. For those of you that stuck with the show, And, you know, a couple hours, 20 minutes, who knows? We're getting close to that line. But for those of you that stuck with the show, and you heard that part earlier about how, like, the bathrooms are great at Alphonic, we're hiring. Be sure to check out the Polycount jobs section and possibly on Gamma Sutra and all these other websites. You know, but we are hiring. So feel free to apply.
Nice.
Do you provide, are you hiring for people for out of the country also, or just in the country only?
Well, unfortunately, we're a very small company.
I'm sorry, Lee, you're out of this world.
And we cannot afford the work visas for people. However, if they already have those and they can come here, then that's great. But we're literally, the game when we made was like a less than a dozen folks. So we just don't have that money. We're not big enough. We're not big enough.
And do you accept interns that work for half price?
Yeah, we accept interns to work for free. There is a little bit of a it's a possible compensation. I can't really comment on that because it's outside of my hands. But I do understand that there is some of our interns did get compensations. And yeah, that's available if you want to fucking hey, I want to work in fucking this awesome engine and stuff. So it's right there. That's what I always say. And look, I'm just gonna go into this because it's a topic and it's legit. If you get the opportunity as some sort of intern or whatever, it is an opportunity for you to be. What is John looking at? Jesus Christ. Is that pornography? Is that porn? Wait. Okay.
He's eating the taco.
No, I meant Mr. Henderson. I thought he was going after it.
And you people on audio have got to be just dying right now.
Why are they, what are they talking about? He's got that crazy gif of like a yeti when a taco is going into his mouth.
He's going to town.
And that was a reference to old school WCW. Yeti.
Nice.
Oh, no, okay. When you're an intern, you're giving an opportunity. When you're an intern, you have this opportunity that you're being surrounded by incredible people. Obviously, you're being surrounded by people that are able to make the game that you're working on. So if you're not, if you are an intern and you don't accept the mentality of being a sponge, just taking in everything that you fucking can, then you're wasting the time of the company. Because most internships are like I said, it's lower pay, but it's not about payment, it's not about recognition, it's about training and learning. And I've worked, and I'm not saying anything about where I'm now, I'm just saying about everywhere I've been. I've seen so many interns just throw this opportunity away. Like imagine you became an intern at, say, like Epic Games. So obviously you're working in like the best shit ever, or you're interning it and you're doing some shit for Crytek or whatever. You know, regardless of the way they treat you because you're an intern or whatever the pay is, you're clearly working with some high level tech. If you're working for a high level tech company, you got some high level tech. So you should be using your time that they give you to do what they tell you to do, but on your own time, you should be using this tech and expanding your portfolio. This is the best. When you're involved in a project that allows you to be involved in high-level technology, this is like the best. This is someone rolling the red carpet out for you. This is someone saying, hey, here it is, do it. Like, I mean, I feel these days you get a lot of opportunity with the free stuff. Unity, UDK, CryEngine 3, SDK, all those things. Unity, Marmoset, all those little engines that are out there that just allows you to real-time render your art beautifully. I feel like it is unfortunate that people would give up opportunities like that. When you have these opportunities presented in front of you, you have to grab them and accept them and take them. And if you're at a company that's actually pushing tech and you figure some stuff out and you get good at it, you really put the time in to understand the tech and give them, let them know that you're dedicated to it, understand it, and also the fact that Jesse and Brandon are wearing the same shirt. for those with the benefit of video. It's a red carpet opportunity.
Why they're wearing the same shirts because they used to live together.
Yeah, they're best friends. Yep. I mean, just imagine like all those major. Like, imagine a hit title, what was the one? Red Dead Redemption, or Mass Effect 3. Imagine the opportunity that someone would have as an intern that was allowed to work on that.
Totally.
Just imagine the people you're around, the networking, the knowledge, the education. It's far better than school.
Anyway. Dude, I could not possibly agree more. And one thing I thought was totally awesome about Vigil they would bring on interns that were like super talented, and they almost always hired every single intern like into a production or artist position based on how much effort and energy and time they're able to put into it. And so much of it is attitude. Like, I've seen situations in just like a lot of companies actually where someone's brought in like super junior or as an intern, is they come in really insecure. And they feel like they need to sort of like assert their, it's not really dominance. They feel like they need to overcompensate for what they're doing instead of just being, not quiet necessarily, but just listening and absorbing. And we're chatting a little sidebar. Apparently we've hit the 2-hour, 30-minute mark, which is beyond the point most people will keep listening. But I really do think this is a good opportunity to have like extra additional content, potentially. For interns, I mean, just stay humble, stay hungry. Experience, like 6 months of experience on an actual shippable title on almost anything, especially a really big game like that, is going to mean more than 4 years of school. It's just ridiculous. Brandon, oh my god, Brandon, I saw that video the other day. I watched that over and over and over and fucking died. So for the people that don't have video, we're just switching from video to video of it was like cats failing or kids getting hurt. For the last 5 minutes, I've been looping a picture of, or an animated GIF of a corgi in a cute little specially fitted life vest making a bold jump into a lake, and it goes like exactly 6 inches forward, this belly flops super hard, and that's been looping continuously. But if you get an opportunity to be an intern, just do whatever it takes to be able to make that happen, absorb as much information as you possibly can, respect those around you, and you can earn their respect and get your way in. There are a lot of companies that will intern to hire, and just assume that's the case and work your ass off and do the best that you can. Don't stop doing things outside of work as long as it's healthy for you to spend that kind of time doing it. But it's like Chris said, I agree with every single fucking word he said. It's a golden opportunity to really get up, get ahead, and make that work. And Chris and I have been, I've known Chris since 1996. Jesus Christ, since 1996 for more than half my life. And he and I have always been like right there together talking about, you know, getting into the industry, best practices, how to be professional, how to put yourself forward, I mean, professionally, how to learn the most you can, how to deal with this and that, but mostly about young artists, young game developer, just personal development. And we've logged, I'm not kidding, thousands of hours of conversation, like 8 to 10 hours a day for years at a time, just going over all this, looking at portfolios, critiquing them, just the two of us together, thinking about things people could do better, how we can better ourselves, how we can really push the state of our art professionally. And just finding ways to, well, he and I, as I said, are both living our dreams. We're living our fucking dream. And we think back about what we did right, what we did wrong, what we saw other people do, what worked, what didn't. And we're trying to come to some sort of grand unified theory of, if you want to work in games, here's the best way to do it with a minimum of bullshit. And he and I have seen eye to eye for, like Chris, I was saying, like we've known each other for, I think, like 16 years. Something insane like that.
I first met John Jones, UFC champion, when he was 12 years old. And it sounds kind of dirty, but I was also a little kid too. I was like 16 or something, maybe 18 or whatever. I bought a computer. Consensual. And what I'd do is I would spit on it. And no, yeah, it's like we've known each other a long fucking time. Anyway, go with your story.
Oh, I was sort of just leading out of it, just saying that we've talked for our entire careers about how to get in the games, how to do better, what other people can do better, and to try to help up the people around us learn from the things we've done right, we've done wrong, what other people have done right, what they've done wrong, to kind of get like a grand unified theory of getting into games and getting to where we are, where we're happy with what we're doing. We feel like we're doing what we need to do.
Well, right.
And
it's like
we're happy doing it, and we're getting paid to do it.
It's all by example. Like, look, if you look back at your portfolio, Repel's jobs plug, you know that article that was all you. But it was
a culmination of years still, of conversation.
Yeah, exactly.
Of us.
I was going to say the exact same word, culmination, because it's such a good word to say. But yeah, we both had that culmination of ideas because we had both, right at that time in our careers, we had recently been subjected to that whole concept of sending out job requests and then taking in all the emails from everybody and seeing this huge stack of portfolios. And literally you're getting dozens and dozens of emails in a single day or whatever. It's horrible. But the idea that you're going right to content, and if you don't go right to content, you just close it. If it's taking a second to load, it just goes right by you. And I saw this recently, and it's not like me and you. We both have an understanding of these the things that we know are wrong. So I feel like for me, since then, I've used that as an education, not to the people making portfolios or whatever. I use it as education to myself to know what to look for to make sure that I go deep enough to really find their content. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Like I'm using it in the opposite direction where I'm saying, hey, you know what? I'm looking at this article. I'm saying, like, yeah, he's right. You get it's like a big stack of emails and they're all the same portfolios over and over and over and over and over. But sometimes the art is like you got to do like, yes, like, here's the old joke. We go all the way back. GeoCities, 1997.
Oh, God.
Splash page. GeoCities, you got a splash page. It's got your name on it. It's got no art. You click on the splash page. The splash page takes you to the main page. The main page is like some fucking shit on the top. It's like my name and fucking portfolio, resume, and shit. But it's still another splash page, but there's no art. It's all text. It's like, hey, I just like making video games and fucking stupid and whatever. Shut up, hire me. So you click on portfolio, and you click on portfolio, and it says, okay, portfolio. You go, bam, poof. And then it's not art. You know what it is? It's a list. It says characters, environments, props, something else. But then you click on characters, and all right, characters, here we go, bam. All right, boom, and then there's like a list of thumbnails. It took me this long, but finally I found the thumbnail of Man with Axe. And yeah. It's still a reality today, and you run into it all the time. And it seems like it comes in cycles, too, like a school will be close to graduation. Where they do that shit where they're like, hey, make a portfolio, huh? And you'll get on PolyCount, you'll get a wave of portfolios that are all the same exact portfolio using the same, like some crap like Wix.
At graduation time.
Yeah. You guys know about Wix, right?
and Chris, one thing I wanted to say was, I feel like the difficulty to getting into the industry has changed a lot from when we got in. It used to be, like, these days, it's all the tools are at your disposal, and they're more user-friendly than ever. I feel like a lot of the difficulty was just getting up to date with the latest tech and learning how to deal with it as best as we can. Like, but there wasn't really the glut of people that are trying to get into games like there are now. Of course, you still have to get up the tech.
There's
but
way more
now it's more trying to get noticed.
Yes.
Than trying to learn your shit well enough to be perceived as technically competent enough to get in. Like, you still have to do that, but the main difficulty is getting noticed in that kind of crowd, in my opinion.
Right, no, that's absolutely fair. I always tell people, have a remember me piece in your portfolio. Do like some really high level, awesome technical stuff, whatever, but then have like something really wacky. still good quality, but something really wacky, just because they'll remember you.
Absolutely.
I've seen so many times where, okay, take the idea, like I said, I was goofing on Wix earlier because it's Flash and it's garbage and fuck you for making a Flash website. Don't use Flash, fuck you. if I can't right-click and save your images, and those images don't have your URL on them, then you might be losing some jobs based on stupid shit like that because people are fucking stupid.
Dude, and your portfolio repels jobs. In October, it'll be 7 years that's been out, up. And people still do this.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about earlier. I'm like, that's the most upsetting point is that, you know, you try to set these standards from years ago. But then here you are running into the same problems. It never stops.
And I'm just, like, I really feel like...
Hey, let's do 100% shape recognition and crazy bump on this fucking Google image I made a tiling texture of and call it, put that in my portfolio and think that I'm actually going to fucking get a job. Ugh. Yeah. Yeah.
It's ridiculous. I mean, I feel like, I mean, you and I have been around long enough that we've kind of gone through at least a generation or generation and a half beyond where we started out.
Well, so the weird thing is, problems. We were hiring before normal maps, and now we're hiring into DX11, which is actually, we've probably been working with that whole process over three generations of games, and people like John Henderson, who is clearly taking a break, is, you know, possibly the most experienced person here, short of Jesse Sosa, who worked on Grandma's Boy. And just because he worked on movies and was such a huge celebrity in Hollywood, and he like has like TMZ paparazzi are following him everywhere.
Oh, I'll be back in a second.
Whoa! What was that?
That was John Jones exploding.
Yeah, again. I have an...
Also, you know, another thing is it's always good to go on Polycount, or if you belong to another forum, but Polycount's better, then I would say post your stuff, and then before you send it to companies, post your portfolio, let people look at it, get feedback from others.
Oh, yeah, that's... Like, I feel like that is like the most basic shit, but people don't do that.
No. But then, you know, people ask, well, you know, I sent my stuff in, and then you look at it, and you're like, well, I would have taken out that, and it's like, well, that's half my portfolio gone.
I always tell people to take all their shit out of their portfolio.
Yeah.
I'll admit it. Well, the first thing I say to people is, I say, take all this shit out of your portfolio and just use this one piece.
Yeah.
I've seen that so many times.
I will narrow down... I'll simplify what you just said into what a lot of motherfuckers do on Polycount is they post in general discussion, I can't get a job thread. And it always turns into a portfolio review. But it gets a lot more heat, like a lot more attention, just because they GD'd it. And I worry it becoming a trend, but anyway.
There's a time and a place. And I feel like that kind of thing is sort of tacky, and no matter how,
it is,
like, unless that guy is an absolute god, I'd still market against him just because that's tacky. I think that's sort of like what we were talking about earlier, just social decorum. If you can't even hold your shit up in a forum where people can't see your face, can't see your body language, can't see your attitude, can't see anything, if just the way you present yourself through text, you can still manage to look like a douche.
Oh yeah, sarcasm doesn't work in text. But I wanted to get back to John Henderson had a point he was about to make.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, it wasn't you. Wait.
So a lot of times since I'm the IGDA guy, I get people coming up to me and things like, we'll have a booth at GDC online and we'll have another one in the fall. And the last one we had, like the last day is when they bring in all the students. And I'll have a conversation with them about, you know, it'll be something like, what is your aspiration, or tell me about the game project you're actually working on. And they've said the damnedest things to me at different times, and I feel really sorry for them sometimes. Like the guy who was like, he was a programmer, and he said, should I finish my degree or should I finish this game project? And it's like, what the hell kind of question is that? When you're talking about polycount, I could almost imagine, I could probably come up with the stereotypes, and you can tell me right now, because I don't spend a lot of time on polycount. I bet I can stereotype most of the people you're thinking about when you're thinking about people complaining about jobs and need portfolio review. You got one, the guy who is obsessed on this one model and can't do anything else but do what he thinks is tweaking or polishing that one thing. Then you got that one that's just super prolific, but everything he does is shit, and he doesn't have any sense of quality at all.
Yeah, piece to piece, they don't improve.
Then there's another one.
I can name some guys.
Who?
I'm just kidding. I don't remember them.
I'm just kidding, their listeners.
There's one that's like paranoid about being judged at all, so they'll write novels about their passion and about creating game art, but then they never post anything.
Is it the voice of God?
What just happened? Are you okay? Did you have a stroke?
Correct me if I'm wrong. These are things that I've seen a lot of people that supposedly have the aspiration to create, but then they don't create anything, or that no one has really inspired them in a way that makes them want to do better. And that's the real tragedy in my mind. We're never going to run out of people who are fascinated and inspired in some way or a way they think is inspiration to create stuff, but then they never actually get around to making anything that it's not even good enough for a hobby, let alone a career.
I agree. It's better to just have forward momentum and make stuff, even if it sucks, as long as you try and do a little bit better next time. Aspirations and inspiration mean fuck all unless you have something positive and tangible to even look at. Just, even if you fail, like I've always heard the thing like about artists. Every artist has 10,000 bad drawings in them. It's just a matter of getting to 10,001 before you start to be really good. You can talk a great game, but unless you do shit.
Writers get told the same thing. It's a creative thing. You get the crap out of you. Just make it. Just do it. And don't be afraid to be judged at some point. At some point, you're going to have to judge yourself, and you better be your best critic. Because other people will just tear you apart and disregard you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, here's the one thing that I say to a lot of people that are trying to get into this shit. They're trying to make these portfolios, trying to get in this game. They're trying to make some art. And no matter what anyone says to you about your art, no matter how negative, even though it might be right, that's what I'm talking about, is the idea of like when someone gives you really harsh criticism, this accurate. No matter how negative you believe that is, it's not even close. It's not even like it's 10 times, 100 times less negative than being rejected for a job. So what anybody says to you doesn't really matter. You need to understand, like, sometimes that's valuable. You need to listen to it. That guy's an asshole. Fuck him. But maybe he's right. Maybe you need to fucking get your fucking game together. But he doesn't really matter, because no matter how harsh you think that criticism is not even close to somebody saying, no, you're not good enough to work for my company.
Yep.
And that's
those people will steal your resolve.
Okay, that's the point I'm making. Never let somebody say some bullshit and fuck you up. Like, you take it, learn from it. But
and giving attention is giving you respect.
You should never be upset about that, because it's not even close. That cat is going into a bag. Hey, somebody just joined the hangout.
James Everett, what's up, motherfucker?
Holy shit, John.
How's it going, dude?
What the shit?
Those Venetian blinds.
So, James is a good old buddy of mine I've known forever.
Now I'm in a chat room. What the fuck happened here?
Yeah, this is the CrunchCast, the game dev video podcasting I do. Chris
Christ, you're not recording it right now, are you?
No, we're not. Sorry.
Oh, thank goodness. That would have been really awkward. Why is there no pants in that fucking picture? What's going on? There's a cat. There's pants. There's what the... just a gift bin? Oh, shit. Never mind. I am way not in the headspace for this shit. What is going on?
It would have made a lot more sense if you'd been here earlier. Trust me, everything is a perfect logical progression of everything that led before it.
Well, you know, so I've been drinking an exceptional amount, and I just fled a strip club because it was fucking terrible, and this I was trying perfect. To find man beer, and now there's a video, like five video things on my
this
screen.
This is perfect.
I think I clicked on the wrong
James, thing. Mr. Everett. We're not really, we've never really met before. My name is Chris Holden. Hey, James, nice to meet you.
Hey, Chris Holden.
But I have a question for you. And I really want you to really think about this because, you know, I respect you as a person and you're the blinds behind you and probably the fact that people know you all, that John knows you, so you probably are, you know, like, you probably do something.
He's in game dev. You're in Toronto.
Fantastic. So here's what I serious question, honestly.
Hit me.
4D in games. In gameplay space. What do you think about that?
What the fuck is 4D? What are you, Peter Molyneux?
James, I just gotta say, you are awesome.
No, I'm the game designer that introduced UML to a bunch of French motherfuckers to get them to stop waving their hands. And this gift bin thing keeps looping in my face and it's freaking my shit out. I feel like I've just intruded horribly on a conversation here that was probably very important.
Yeah, well,
sort of, but it's okay.
Kind of what we're doing here, we're doing a live internet podcast on the websites that people can see on in the internet. Yeah, they take satellites that come through the air and it gets them to them.
Please tell me you're
wrong. And what we're doing is we started a design document about 4D in games in gameplay space, and that's the whole thing. And it started 2 hours and 45 minutes ago, and the whole thing has been just about that. And it's a huge game doc, and we're pretty deep in. We just, you know how like most stories have like a, you know, the main three chapters, like, yeah, whatever. We're about halfway through chapter 2 right now in the game design doc. And so we're happy you're here.
You don't actually have a game designer involved in this, do you?
No, everything I just said was fraudulent.
You guys are superfluous.
Yeah, everything I said was completely fraudulent. It was just a joke.
But I can tell you that if you've been working on story, you're not working on design. So something's gone fucking horribly wrong here.
So actually, so James, this is actually a spontaneously generated inside joke. Chris was coming up with a list of topics for tonight, like you know, the credits and games thing, the Darksiders guy.
Oh, dude, that sounds like some bullshit. Whatever happened there? There's some bullshit on one side of that story. I don't know what happened.
Both. I know the guy. I know the situation. I was actually, Chris, is this still recording?
Yes.
Oh, I want to talk about this.
Shit, you are recording this? Oh, this is son of a bitch.
James,
oh,
this,
I'm getting
this
out
is,
of here.
No, dude, these
I'm
are
bailing.
The,
I'm
no, these, are the, these are the extras. No, these are the extras. Nobody, almost no one will ever actually watch this. But I wanted to explain
almost,
the 4D thing.
Almost isn't good
that's
enough.
Why well, I immediately. That's why I immediately sure threw a crazy topic at you, on? So you wouldn't say
so,
anything
so, yeah.
crazy.
So, James, so Chris came up with like the credits in games, NDAs, non-competes. He was
Mars.
Like super late at Mars, like the Curiosity Lander. And he wrote down this thing, 4D in games, in game space, when he was super fucking tired and nobody could figure out what the fuck that means. So we're just fucking riffing
so
on
I've been
it.
Going back to it, yes.
it's complete horseshit. None of us have any idea what that could possibly mean. But our little joke is, like, for a couple of people who are like paying a ton of attention, it's like, so what do you think of this? And acting all serious about it. So we're genuinely curious at what you said, but you had absolutely the best fucking possible answer it is there could be. That was awesome. And by the way, we're all drunk as well.
Okay, I feel like I should pour myself a scotch if I'm going to continue this. I might even crack open the balcony because I haven't done that yet.
Hey, James, which where one? Are you located?
I'm in Toronto.
Toronto.
It's a weird
Canadian.
Place.
Are you on the Splinter Cell project?
Yeah.
Nice.
Sick as fuck. Hey, do you want to tell anybody what you do?
Do I want to what?
Do you want to tell people what you do?
You're not recording this. You can't record this. This is not cool.
It's been recording. You joined a live record of the show.
Son of a bitch.
You did this. It was your... You knew what...
I was looking for man beer, man.
You're looking for what? Men?
I was looking for man beer.
Men?
He's James is super gay.
Well, yeah, but I was hot for man beer.
Oh, okay.
So man beer Air was the lead designer on the... on a canceled game from Raven. He's up in BioWare Montreal now. He is a crazy, hilarious motherfucker.
Yes, who likes good beer. We appreciate good beer. And bourbon. We're big on the bourbon. And why is Lucy after me?
So, hey, James, what's your handle on Twitter?
Why?
We're going to promote you.
Oh,
You can't do any of this shit to me. You can't. Why am I still talking to you? This is not good.
Well, you are live. This is a show. A lot of the people in this hangout are actually just audience members. They're not really participating.
You said there was like four people in this fucking thing. I saw this. There's no way.
Dude, it's so good to see you. I missed you.
This is just like an episode of Roseanne.
Fucking ever, John. And this is why I was trying to find man beer, because we were both like drunk off our asses and going like, dude, okay, I have man beer. How do I invite someone to this hangout thing?
I will.
Okay, you have to invite man beer. This is going to be amazing. Or terrible.
Oh, I feel like the show is already degraded into some craziness right at this point, because we got so off topic by the fact that you can't understand that I hit record buttons years ago. But that's hilarious to everyone.
So here's the thing. John Jones is masquerading as a cat falling down a banister or some shit.
Well, you know, here's what
shit on the go.
You know what,
there's
John,
dog shit strapped to his face. and headphone people, and then the man in the dark, and I genuinely don't know what's happening here.
I gotta put this on camera for those that can't see all the little faces of people.
James, do you know what the CrunchCast is?
I do know of the CrunchCast, because I know of John Jones, which means I know of the CrunchCast, because it's hard to not know.
He's got like 1,000+ followers on Twitter.
So there was a question about 4D something something, and
4D in games.
Were you actually referring to time as a design element, or were you just like making shit up?
I didn't. The word time is never expressed in this statement. 4D in games, in gameplay space. Yeah, now, the assumption is 4D is time.
Now you're talking about time plus space, right? So now you're getting like really complicated.
That's the whole point.
This is like Will Wheaton shit.
It's the deepest conversation that ever happened, ever.
Wow.
No.
Wesley Crusher.
That dude is all over Google Plus.
What have you got for Wesley Crusher, man?
Man boner.
That's a thing. That's a thing.
So, So James, just to catch up, like earlier on, we were talking about credits in games and the inclusion or a disinclusion thereof, like NDAs and non-competes, and how, like, in what ways they can be bad, how to kind of negotiate your way out of them, how to learn to read them. They went some My Little Pony shit for a while. I have no idea fucking why. And then just like that topic that Chris came up with in his sleep that we still can't figure out. But on a more serious note, like about the credits in games, and you've read that whole thing with the Darksiders 2, right?
I had a very brief look at it. It's, that's a really serious set of accusations to level against somebody. So I have zero knowledge of the actual, of either side of that story. So, you know, zero firsthand knowledge, or even secondhand knowledge. I assume that all shit that gets published on game news sites is sixth hand at best.
Yeah.
So I got nothing there. I mean,
so this guy worked at Vigil for just shy of 3 months. He designed a tremendous amount of the user interface art for that. He ran a small team doing so. And he's only there for 3 months, and he wasn't credited on the game at all, even though a tremendous amount of it was, in my experience, legitimately his. Not my experience. I wasn't there at the same time as him, but based on everybody I know there, a lot of it was his. And he was complaining about not being included in the credits, and I think he did it in a very, very fucking tasteless way, where he was naming names and levying really brutal accusations, and is essentially, in my opinion, the career equivalent of putting a gun in your mouth and pulling the trigger as many times as you can, just career-wise.
Yeah, that was not a smart move at all. I mean,
I know the guy that he accused, and I felt really bad for him, because that was really poor judgment to call somebody out.
Well, the guy he called out is about the nicest guy you ever meet.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
More importantly, you know, everyone knows him exactly like that. If this guy had any bone in his body, then maybe it would actually stick, but the truth is that no one thinks this guy is malicious in any sense. So
he's also one of the co-founders of Ensemble.
Yeah.
The guy that was accused of stealing his job. He was a co-founder of Ensemble. He's won 2 Academy Awards for the shit he's done in games. He created the UI for Age of... You sound like a dog barking when you sneeze.
It's because I'm trying not to sound like the guy with the dog face looks.
Oh. Hey, John.
I don't know what's going on there, man. All I can see is there's a level editor, there's a cat in a banister, there's a dog face dude, a dude in the dark, and headphone guys. It's kind of confusing.
I would be on camera, but my camera broke. I think I need to reboot, but that'd take way too long. But, so the guy that got accused by the guy that's complaining is one of the nicest people in the world. I consider him a very good friend. And, yeah, founder of Ensemble, Academy Award winner. He pioneered the UI of the modern RTS and whose conventions still exist to this day. And he is, like, the god of user interface art. And he got called out by this dude saying that he stole his job and all sorts of weird sour grapes shit. But aside from that, he actually did, even though it was the bitterest way possible of expressing that, I think he did bring up a really good point in terms of who gets included in credits, who doesn't. And what are the politics behind that? What the fuck can you do? Do you even know who is involved in creating the list of credits? Right? Like at a studio, and what goes into that?
Was this guy a noob?
No, he's been in games for about 3 years. But he's only worked in companies for like 4 to 6 months at a time, like contract type stuff.
There's stints.
I mean, that's totally... There's huge value in people who are able to come in, do a job, get a thing done, bounce out again. That's massive, and that's really, really tricky. And it's super challenging, and I have massive respect for those people. But if he's been doing that for 3 years kind of off and on, like, if you haven't been around for this shit show that is closing a project and shipping it and seeing how credits get dealt with in a fucking Excel file or some shit, that, I mean... You know, it sucks, but...
That's exactly what I said. I said Excel file of just list of people.
Yeah, and it turns into or an INI file or somebody's goddamn XML bullshit that they've exported out of it.
It's a Google document these days for all the kids out there.
A what?
Yeah, the kids out there. They're using Google Docs. That's all they do.
Like a AAA thing?
That's a future shit.
No, just for assembling data like that, like in a Google Docs spreadsheet.
Yeah,
like that.
Google Docs are the fucking future. So everybody's Google doing Docs. That shit. Anyway.
And actually, real quick. Oh, go ahead, Chris.
Hey, check this out. Well, I got to wrap up this particular podcast tonight here for everybody. You know what I'm saying? I'm a disc jockey impersonating one. Hey, what do you want to be, John? What, John, what is your name? Like Henderson? like
or James Everett.
Like Wendy and the Pud or Dog and the James. Or, you know what I mean? I'll be Nail Gun and you'll be what? What do you want to be?
I like Pud.
Pud? Nail Gun in the Pud, cutting out here on the CrunchCast. Yeah, like we're like old school
what?
Shock Jock radios. This is what you call an outro.
So he's going to stop recording. We're going to keep chatting.
So anybody that wants to promote anything, now is the time to final promote. You got like 1 minute to promote.
James, can I put your Twitter in?
Dude, I don't even know what you have on me at this point.
You haven't said anything bad, don't worry. What is Austin at Austin I G D A as in Austin as in like A U S T I N.
Brandon's website again.
You can find me at Bruce3D.com.
Bruce3D.com.
Yes.
AustinGameDev.org. JohnJones.com. CrunchCast. It's not a website. It's Crunch Studios. What is that all about? Why is it two different names? Because it was given to me by James Green. You buy that Air Mac game.
Actually, yeah, James Everett knows James Green.
And then you're, yeah. And you're great.
James Green's good people. What am I? Where do you find me? If you want to find me, brainofjames.com.
Brainofjames.com.
Brain of James. That's me, man.
By the way, dude, that's a great domain.
There,
I don't know if
you've
ever said that.
You can also find luscious.org goes right
to that
portfolio.
Just sucks that I never update it. The most commonly updated piece of that is like the Flickr auto rotator on the side when I upload photos from some fucking bar I've been shooting at or something.
So yeah, thanks John Henderson for being here. You quiet motherfucker. You were amazing. You told so many crazy things that people are going to have to listen to these things. This is the longest episode ever done. You got to listen to it several times to just pick up on half this information and really understand what it means about respect and game developers and all that shit. And Lee Amarakoon is here. He's been pandering to me as hard as possible by the entire time. He started working on a Nexus map, which is a game I just released, and he switched to UDK, and he's using my level that I released recently here,
yes,
to build a level, assets. And, you know, no matter what happens between us, no problem now. But if there's ever a reason where, like, he needs to apologize to me, he's already got 2 I'm sorries just from this. So, yeah, thanks for everybody listening and checking it out. And I'm gonna click some buttons here so it stops.
Puzzle.